across the Rocky Mountains in the morning. And it's one too many lonely nights when the highway comes to be a way of life. Seems like about the time I'm getting there, I'm going. Hear the Peter Bell whine down the solid white line.
Well, how about that? Once again, our friends from the band Midland, kind enough to, let us use 14 Gears there as our theme show, the music for our show, and welcome to the PBL Roundup Show. I'm your host, one of your hosts anyway, Thom Brennaman. Happy to have you with us for week three of our show. And so tonight we'll be checking in naturally of everything going on around the Pioneer League, but also some of the people, some of the owners, some of the places, and the culture of such a beautiful part of the country. Now, tonight, our featured game, the Billings Mustangs, their game against the Missoula Paddleheads. And we had the chance, I had the chance, along with Henry Hunter and Jackson Shapiro, we went out and visited both of those ball clubs in both of those cities. And really, we've had some technical difficulties the last couple of weeks. So we'd like to circle back with some of the things that we did while we were out there. And let's get right to it. Bring in my partners here, or partners, as they say, out in that part of the country on the PBL Roundup Show. Comedian Joe List and former Major League Baseball general manager Billy Bavasi. Now, Joe, you've been in London. You've been in Washington. Where are you this week?
Right now, I am in my home sweet home in Queens, New York, home of the New York Mets, and I've been in literally London and Gig Harbor at a crappy hotel, and now I'm in my home, and the internet is spotty, so I couldn't use my background. You could just see my crummy apartment here. I'm embarrassed. I feel humiliated. I feel like a kid that showed up for picture day without the right outfit. I just feel like a putz, but I'm here in Queens. This is my home. That's the closet.
Now, why do you say, we've already established on this show, before we get to Bill, why do you say the home of the, I know that Queens is a home of the Mets, but you're a Red Sox guy, which means you can't like the Mets, right?
I don't like the Mets. I have to say, I'm kind of like, I go to the most Mets games, yeah. But I just wanted to make it seem like baseball. I'm throwing some baseball out there.
Okay, all right.
But I have been to more Mets games than I've been to Red Sox games the last few years. And the Mets fans, the Mets, they hate the Yankees. They're like the team that hates the Yankees the second most. So I do have a soft spot for the Mets. But if my father hears this, he's going to come down here and shoot me in the face. So.
And Billy, are you on the home front, or where are you, in Southern California tonight, or no?
No, I'm on the road. I'm in right now. I'm in Midway, Utah, and I'm on my way to. I'm working my way to Ogden, Utah. Beautiful Ogden, one of my favorite minor league cities.
Where is Midway, Utah? Midway between
It's down the hill from Park City.
Oh, well, that's right next to Park City.
Yeah, Park City, Deer Valley, and then Midway. This is where you go if you can't afford Park City.
Yeah, well, then that's why I probably will become very familiar. I used to know Park City. Now I'll end up in Midway, but that's okay. We are what we are. We have game correspondents, as always. For those of you joining us for the first time, we have a partnership and an agreement with both the Newhouse School at Syracuse University, the broadcast school, and also the Falk School of Analytics. And we were using these guys all season long to help us out and check in on games that are going on around Major League Baseball, or around the Pioneer League, forgive me. Carter Lewis is handling the Glacier Range Riders, and they're at Great Falls tonight. Hayden Wasserman will do the Billings Mustangs at Missoula. That's our featured game tonight. Matthias Altman-Kurosaki on the Northern Colorado Owls against Ogden. Austin Murphy with the Boise Hawks at Grand Junction, the Rockies game there. And our buddy Owen Trainer has been with us all 3 weeks, handling the Idaho Falls Chuckers against the Rocky Mountain Vibes. Gentlemen, welcome, and great to have you with us here tonight. We'll be checking in with you guys throughout the rest of the night. Joe, we're getting ready for first pitch, my man.
Joe, me?
Joe, you, we're getting ready.
I thought you were throwing to somebody else. I'm an idiot. Well, as we're at the first pitch of tonight's game, I thought it might be a good time to introduce a new regular segment we're going to be doing called It's Harder Than It Looks. And last Saturday, which I say that for this show, by the way, it is harder than it looks. And last, what was it? Last Saturday? Well, last show, I can't remember. The Billings Mustangs invited Thom, our very own Thom Brennaman, to throw out the first pitch of the game. And he did a knock-up job. And I believe there is some video footage of this. If I'm getting this right in my ear, we have footage.
There should be if there is. All right. Well, we got it to the plate, Joe. That's all that matters. You know what I mean?
It looked beautiful to me. I got to say, when there's a video playing, I think that's when my computer goes wacky. But it looked like a good throw, first class all the way. And it was raining, which doesn't help.
No, the rain was not good. And I mean, look, anybody that's ever had a chance to do it, it's a great honor. And I appreciate Dave Heller and his ownership group asking me to do that. But, I mean, it is a little nervous. I mean, I'm out there with the mayor. He threw it out along with the city manager. And I'm thinking, these two guys are going to throw lasers and I'm going to bounce one up there. I told the catcher right beforehand. I said, listen, I said, if I get it there in the air, I said, you better catch it. And so the mayor throws it. He catches it. City manager throws a strike right down the middle. He drops the ball. And I walked down before I threw it. I said, dude, you got to catch the ball if we get it there in the air. And he made the play. So we're all good.
Now you did a fantastic job. And this tradition of throwing out the first pitch goes all the way back. I'm sure you guys already know this, but maybe the folks at home don't know. It goes all the way back to President William Howard Taft, who I believe was our fattest president.
Yes, and he's from Cincinnati. He loves Skyline Chili. That's why.
There you go. Well, you got stuck in a bathtub at some point, which I heard was a myth, but I'm sticking with it. It was April 14th, 1910, the first president to do it. And now, ever since, every president has thrown out a first pitch except for one named Donald J. Trump, who is not that controversial a president. So interesting that he didn't get to throw a first pitch. But that was also where the seventh inning stretch started, because Taft, Fat Taft, he stood up to stretch and everyone didn't, no one wanted to be disrespectful. No one wanted to be disrespectful because it was the president. And so everyone stood up, and that became another wonderful tradition, the seventh inning stretch.
How about that? You learn something every day. That's good stuff, Joe.
I did not know that.
Thank you. I mean, Fat Taft.
That's a good nickname, I think. And,
I think it is.
I think I'm coming out swinging. I'm just killing it here today. And can I just make a quick note that I'm a cool guy that has water in a can. It's one of the sponsors of my podcast. So I'm not drinking a big, tall beer. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I just don't want you to think I'm knocking them back at work here.
That's all right. You're allowed. Next week, you want to knock one back, knock one back. You want to knock one back tonight, no big deal. You know, we were out there, and you saw the video there from Billings, and we had a chance to meet Dave Heller. Now, I had heard the name Dave Heller, and just for some background on this guy, he's a top-flight political media consultant. And, I mean, he's handled some of the biggest politician household names for years and years and years. But he's a majority owner and the managing partner, not only of the team in Billings, but three teams total, the Quad City River Bandits, and they're an advanced affiliate of the Kansas City Royals, A-Ball, the Wilmington Blue Rocks, that's an advanced A affiliate of the Washington Nationals, and, of course, the Billings Mustangs. He's won virtually every award that you can win that they give out for minor league teams. In 2016, he earned the Ballpark Digest coveted Minor League Baseball Organization of the Year Award. It's one of the highest industry honors that you can get. He won Baseball America's Most Accomplished Franchises during the entire decade from 2010 to 2020. This year, he's already been honored by the Kansas City Royals with their Matt Minker Award, which is given to the outstanding person in the entire Royals minor league system. And I'm telling you, if you've never seen this ballpark, and Billy, I'm going to ask you about it in a few minutes after we hear from Heller, but the ballpark that he has there in the Quad Cities, it's built on an island surrounded by water and this amusement park. It's one of the most incredible things you've ever seen. But ever since he bought ownership in these teams, he's really known for four things. And I mean, everybody in minor league baseball, major league baseball knows everything he does. Number one, fun. Number two, very innovative as far as promotions go. Makes significant ballpark improvements. And maybe the thing most of all is he gives back to every single one of these communities millions and millions and millions of dollars to help kids get scholarships, among many other things. So sit back and enjoy this conversation and meet for the first time, if you don't know, Dave Heller. So what, I mean, your education, layer upon layer upon layer.
Yeah.
What led you, was it just a love of baseball to want to be a part of baseball, and in your case, as an owner?
So, you know, for me, I had spent my career making political commercials, and would talk about all the different ways that my clients have given back to their community and all the impressive and interesting things that these men and women who have sought political office have done with their lives. And at some point, it started, you know, pulling on me, what's my legacy? What have I done? How have I given back? And I thought, you know, I've always loved baseball. And this could be the chance to plant roots in a community and grow strong and tall and give back to a community and to the game that I love. And that's what really led me into baseball.
You've been through now this whole transformation, Dave, of affiliated, not affiliated. You have two teams that still are affiliated. You have a team here in our league that is not affiliated. What have you learned over the last year that maybe you didn't expect, good, bad, or indifferent, about having an unaffiliated team? Is there anything good about it?
Oh, it's more fun.
In what way?
Oh, so you can do things in the Pioneer League that you can't do as an affiliated team. I'll give you an example. When I first got into minor league baseball, when I first bought my Quad Cities club, I started a new promotion. We called it the Mega Candy Drop. We filled up a helicopter with 1,000 pounds of candy, Thom. And we would line up kids along the baselines after the game. And the helicopter would fly over the ballpark and drop the candy down in the outfield. And as soon as the candy hit the ground, we released the rope and the kids would run out and pick up as much candy as they could.
Sure.
And as the kids are picking up the candy, the helicopter would come back and reload, and we'd fill it with giant marshmallows. And then the helicopter would come out there, and as the kids are picking up the first load of candy, the helicopter would fly over and drop the giant marshmallows all over the children. And the kids would look up and go, oh my God, it's raining marshmallows.
right? Absolutely.
And it was so much fun. And every year in Quad Cities, the attendance would grow and grow and grow for the Mega Candy Drop. And we started doing it in Wilmington, and now there were got to be about 30 affiliated teams that started doing some version of the Candy Drop. We do it here in Billings. And so we get to do things here like the Candy Drop that we can't do in affiliated ball anymore. And that's fun.
There are pros to being an affiliated team.
Oh, sure.
And now you guys have found a way to keep it together here in the Pioneer League. How have you been able to keep it together?
I think the biggest thing is, number one, we have a group of owners in the Pioneer League who are great guys, who love baseball, who love these communities, and love the impact that their teams make in these communities and want to make sure that we continue to do that. That's the biggest thing, is just the drive, the determination among all of the Pioneer League owners to keep going, to not be knocked off our track, that I've been so impressed with.
Yeah.
And I'm so proud to be one of them.
The ballpark you have in the Quad Cities, I've always seen pictures of this thing, and I'm still trying to figure out for the life of me how fans got over. I think I may have seen pictures where the river was high and couldn't see physically how they would come into the ballpark.
Yes.
I mean, that place, and it's won all kinds of awards.
Yes.
It's the best minor league ballpark. I mean, that's like the crown jewel, arguably, maybe of all minor league ballparks.
Oh, thank you. We're very pleased with it. It's a special place, right? It's the only ballpark in America with a Ferris wheel yep. in it, right? It's got a 110-foot-tall Ferris wheel. I mean, Detroit has a, you know, a little one, like a little kiddie Ferris wheel. This is 110 feet tall. And the thing that I've seen with my own eyes, which is really special, is people from ages 3 months, 4 months old to 100 years old riding that Ferris wheel, multiple generations in the same gondola. And the one thing they all have in common is they come off that Ferris wheel and they're all smiling.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? And that's neat. We have the only double-decker carousel anywhere between Chicago and Kansas City in our ballpark in Davenport, Iowa. We have a spinning roller coaster for kids. We have a wind-up, a double play, a drop and twist, like all these great carnival rides. And it's like we have a park within a park.
Sure.
And for young people today who aren't like, you know, people in our generation where our dads would take us to the ballpark and teach us to score and we'd keep a scorecard yep. and save them in the attic, yep. right? Kids don't have that kind of attention today. Their attention spans are much shorter. And so you can grouse about it and complain about it and wish it were different, or you can try to meet kids where they are. And that's what we've chosen to do.
A lot of teams do a lot to improve their ballpark and the quote-unquote ballpark experience. But to be able to navigate that whole thing with the players, I think, is where they're missing it.
That's part of the fun. That's yeah. part of the specialness.
Yeah.
Right? I tell my staff every day, whether they're in Montana or Quad Cities or Wilmington, Delaware, our job is not, we're not in the baseball business. We're not in the entertainment business. We are in the memory-making business. Mm-hmm. And our job is to make a memory for a young kid every night. And if we can do that, we've done something special with our day, right?
Yep.
We've really done something. And that's what we try to do. And if you can get a picture with Hunter Green, if you can get a ball signed by Hunter Green, if you can get a broken bat signed by Hunter Green, right? Or any of the other Red Stars who came through Billings, right? From Nick Swisher, I mean, just keep
Ty
going.
Frazier, I saw he made his debut here.
He sure
yeah,
did.
Yeah. And that guy, years later, becomes a home run derby champion.
George Brett here, right. made his career here. Oh, he started here.
No kidding.
George Brett, yeah, Hall of Famer.
Not a bad player.
Right?
Yeah, yeah.
For people who met him. How special is that? That's if they got a picture with George Brett, they will keep that picture for the rest of their lives.
That's exactly right.
How cool is that?
I think there we go. We spent a lot of time with him over the couple of days there in Billings, and just such an interesting guy. Billy, you've known him quite a while, right?
I have. I think it was probably 2002, 2003 in Georgia. He had, I was with the Dodgers. I was the farm director, and we had when I got there, we had a Sally League team, a South Atlantic League team in Wilmington, North Carolina. And unfortunately, the fella decided to not pay the bills. And so they lost the club. And Dave swooped in, got the club. I think we played in Albany the first year and Columbus the second year.
Yeah.
As I think the Wave, South Georgia Wave. And he had nothing to work with there, but you could see, you know, I spent a lot of time with him at the ballpark watching games. You could see he was really, really into it, you know. He was real successful in his media business. And he was really into the fan experience, so you knew he was going to do big things. I've been to his Wilmington ballpark. I watched our Reds club play Kansas City there. I spent a lot of time in what used to be John O'Donnell Stadium, which is now his ballpark in Quad City, and that's got that may have the most picturesque setting of any ballpark in America. It's just gorgeous. Mm-hmm. But I tell you, you know, I can remember when that was not a good franchise. It's not like he walked into something ready made. This guy's really done a lot of things in Wilmington, Quad Cities, and Billings. I had a lot of experience there with the Reds. But you're so right about, you know, I'm glad he got a chance to talk to you about what he does in the community. He does give back. He does care. he's really he's just been great in every community he's been a part of. He's really been good.
And there you see some of the pictures from the Quad Cities Park. There's that, the carousel he was talking about and so forth. And it's just that place looks so cool. Joe, by any chance, Joe, have you ever been in this ballpark? I've never been there.
I haven't, but I got to get out there. It just looks spectacular. And I love the idea of a Ferris wheel. I mean, when I was a kid, I once peed my pants on a Ferris wheel because I got too nervous. But I also peed my pants every time I went to bat in Little League. So Ferris wheels and home plate are very associated. Also, by the way, I would vote for him for president. I mean, he just sounds great and he has the right attitude towards things. But I got to warn everyone, raining down marshmallows on children, you have to be in the right setting, because I have whipped marshmallows at kids and they weren't as thrilled as I'm sure they were at the ball game. These kids were rooting for the Yankees, so I just hit them with a couple heaters from behind.
Well, remind me, if for some reason you and I get to go together to the ballpark there in the Quad Cities in Davenport, I'm not sitting next to you on the Ferris wheel, in case that's...
No, don't sit below me either.
Oh, man. No, but you know, you were talking about the stuff he gave away, and I just found it so interesting. He $5 million worth of to local charities. He endows healthcare programs. He paid for every single person that wanted to get a vaccine during, the whole pandemic in the community up there in Billings, Montana, and in Davenport, Iowa. And so this guy, and academically, I referenced it. But, Phi Beta Kappa from Brown University, gets a master's degree from Oxford over in England. Then he taught at Yale. So, Billy, you and Joe and him, you guys have a lot in common.
I wish he'd try harder. He might get somewhere if he tries harder. That ballpark, it's not an island. That was a picture when they got flooded out.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and I was sitting there when I saw that picture and the river being high up there, and I was wondering how were people getting over the ballpark, and then obviously the river went down, and you can see where it all connects, but it's beautiful.
It is spectacular, man. It's on the mighty Mississippi there, and it's just best. I used to love going to watch our Angel. We had an Angel team that was – actually, we had two stints there. And I think we left and Houston went in there after.
Yeah, Billy, let me ask you a question on that, because I've always wondered why it is. And I can't believe I've never asked you this even in a private conversation. Why is it that teams change cities in – virtually the same league? Why is it? I mean, in Billings, for example, now they were a Reds affiliate for 47 years, the longest running continuously of any minor league team with a major league affiliate, if I'm not mistaken, in all of baseball. But why, for example, pick a team where for 3 years you're in Chattanooga and then, in the same league you're playing in, fill in the blank. Why does that happen?
You got to pay attention to your affiliates. So if you're a major league club, you really have to pay attention to them, because you're going to give them some bad clubs. You're going to give them some teams that aren't very good, because you have prospects that have to play. And some of them are going to struggle, but you got to have them at that level. It's time for them to be at that level. And you really have to stay in touch with that, with your affiliates, general manager, and the owner. And I got to tell you, I wasn't very good at that. I didn't find enough time to take good enough care of those guys. And I think the men and women that work in minor league baseball, they work so hard, and they usually don't have any control over whether they're going to win or lose. That's why you see them so invested in their community and doing such a good job with the fan experience. But there's paying attention to them. And you got to win once in a while. You have to at least give them a decent club. And on the other hand, you need them to take care of your players. You have a covenant with a bunch of these players and their parents that you'll take good care of them. Now you really need them to do that. And so, there's a number of reasons why there are splits. But with the Reds, what I remember is that the local affiliate, the Billings Club, was very reasonable. They were always reasonable about their expectations. And the Reds, we kind of felt the same way. We just had a good relationship with them. And once those years started to pile up, it became really important to us. It really became important to us that 40th year turned into the 41st, and the 41st turned into the 42nd. We really didn't want to be the people in charge of the Reds that got us thrown out of Billings, you know. So we were, you know, we did care about that. It did matter. You know, a lot of the other places, you might have to treat it as a MASH unit. I just told you about what happened in Wilmington. The guy doesn't pay his bills, and right before we go to spring training, we lose that city. And so now we have to find an owner. We have to find a city. And so we were just lucky enough to come along, to have Dave come along. So there's many reasons that the affiliations can go bad. But generally speaking, it's like any other business. It's a relationship business.
Gotcha. Gotcha. Well, when we were there in Billings, we mentioned the Jim Riggleman. Now, Billy, you know all about this, and you know, I for 34 years I'm announcing Major League Baseball. When you get in the big leagues, the travel is beyond description. I mean, you're flying on private planes, big planes. You have an entire row to yourself. You know, it's a regular plane, but there's nobody else on it except for you. It's a charter flight. You've got an entire row to yourself. They're bringing you incredible food. The second you get on the get on the plane, you land. As soon as you land, you don't walk through the airport. There are buses there on the tarmac, take you straight to the hotel, and off you go, right? So when we're in Billings, Jim Riggleman has been traveling like that for how many years has he been in baseball as either a coach or a manager? It has to be 20, 25 years in the big leagues at least, right?
Oh, the big leagues, yeah. He's probably been in baseball for 40, 45 years.
Yeah, right. But the big leagues, that kind of travel. So we were in Billings when he had just taken a bus ride, right? You always hear about the minor leagues and the bus rides. He had just been on a bus ride after a night game. They got into the hotel at 6:30 in the morning. He was going to get maybe 2 hours of sleep. He met us for breakfast, and then he had to be at the ballpark over at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And we had a chance to catch up and visit with Jim Riggleman. Check this out.
Well, Jim, back in the early 1990s, you're managing the Chicago Cubs. I'm announcing the Chicago Cubs. And now here we are 30 plus years later, sitting in Billings, Montana. That's a long time ago, my friend.
That means we're old, right?
Yeah, that's right.
But yeah, you know, those are great days, and these are great days. You know, anytime you get a chance to be in baseball, it's a great opportunity, and I'm honored and thrilled to be here. The experience, you know, it's a different experience because of the travel and you know, the quality of the play that we're fortunate to see at the big league level. But you know, once that umpire says play ball, the competitive juices are flowing, and it's good old baseball.
You were talking about the bus ride. You just got in from a road series at 6 o'clock this morning, and you got a game home opener here tonight as we're taping this. You've been flying charter planes for a long, long time. What was that bus ride like?
Well, there was no flight attendants bringing shrimp and steak. But you know what? I did a lot of that. You know, I played 7 or 8 years of bus rides, and I managed 10 years, 12 years of bus rides. And so you know, it's not great, but it's, you know what you're getting into when you take it, and enjoyed the ride. You know, it's beautiful Montana during the day when you're doing it. It's all good. You know, you just wish we were coming on that bus ride with a couple wins instead of three losses.
What's the difference managing the kids who are playing in this league, the young men who are in this league, as opposed to back when you were managing in the minor leagues? Major leagues, different ball game. What's the difference? Is there any difference?
It's similar. It's very similar. The thing about the minor leagues, at least when you had to give somebody some bad news, quite often you were saying, we're going to send you down a level. Here, you're pretty much saying, we've got to release you. We don't have a minor league system for you to go to. So, you know, you're breaking some hearts when you do it. That's the uncomfortable part. You know, you bring in 32, 34 players. You know, you're going to break 25. So there's going to be some guys who get told, and maybe for the last time, that you know the dream is over. So a lot of concern for that. And this group that we had here, just unbelievably the class that they displayed as they got that news. I mean, they're sending me texts saying thank you so much for the opportunity. I really enjoyed the days there and our quote-unquote spring training. And so, you know, you learn a lot about these guys, and just about all of it's been good.
I don't know if you think about it this way at all, but maybe you do. I don't know. By coming to this level of baseball in an independent league, in the Pioneer League, is there a part of you that feels like, you know, you've been given so much in baseball, this is a chance for you to give something back, or not really? You just like the managing part of it. You like the people part of it. You like the ballpark part of it, all of it.
Great question. There, you know, there's a little bit of all that that you just said. Certainly, you know, when you're out here working with some guys, whether it's base running or, you know, defensive positioning, these type of things, and they're just soaking it up like a sponge, you know, the respect they show you. And you like giving back that information because, you know, some of what we're doing is some of these guys are going to stay in the game. So we're kind of coaching some of these guys up to be future coaches. So, you know, we're just trying to give them a lot of information and hopefully some of them sign affiliated baseball and somebody moves to the major leagues. But the reality of it is a lot of these guys are going to end up teaching baseball themselves, and it can only be good for the game for everybody to have as much information as you can.
Last thing I want to ask you about, you know, for a long time it seemed like the major league level, they were hiring all these young guys who were a game, a year or two maybe out of playing the game, and now all of a sudden they're big league managers and so on and so forth. And now all of a sudden in the last couple of years, you know, whether it's Dusty getting another chance to come back, Buck Showalter now is back in the game, there are other examples of that. I mean, could this be the kind of thing where maybe Jim Riggleman gets another shot at it?
I don't think I'll get a shot based on me being here. You know, it's like so many things in the game, it's who you know in terms of your relationship. You know, Buck and Dusty, the two that you mentioned, their resume is so complete. You know, they've done so many great things. The win-loss ledger speaks very favorably for them. So if you want an experienced guy running your club, you go get those guys. Those of us who, you know, the Rigglemans and Dave Tremblys of the world and some of the other guys who your win-loss record isn't what theirs is, it's tough to sell that to your fan base that, hey, we're going to bring in an old-timer, and by the way, he's lost a lot of games, you know. So, you know, I'd be surprised if that happened. I would welcome it. If the right guy ended up being a general manager somewhere and said, hey, I got one guy I want, it's Jim Riggleman. You know, so I'm at the mercy of who that general manager would be.
But hey, we're rooting for you, buddy.
Thank
it's great
you.
To
Appreciate
see you. Good luck this season.
Really enjoy talking to him. And guys, there's no doubt he's such a huge asset for this league in a short amount of time.
Yeah. Hey, he said something there, you know, that he's lost a lot of games. You got to look at the clubs he's been with.
Yeah.
I'm not saying they're bad clubs, but a lot of young players, he was entrusted with a lot of young players. And when he had players that were ready to play well, his clubs played pretty well.
Mm-hmm.
So we talked about this last week. He's really, he's real good when you have to change managers. We've seen two clubs change managers now. And if he was on one of their staffs, he would be the interim manager because he does bring, he brings control. He brings a veteran influence and he brings calm. He organizes things. And as far as the travel and the tough life at the minor league level, you know, I had him with the Reds. He'd been in the big leagues for a long, long time, and yep, he managed our Double-A club there. And you know, the first month of the season, I think he didn't find a place he liked, so he slept in the clubhouse. So he's not above anything. He'll attempt brain surgery, but he'll also shovel manure. He's really a good organization guy.
You know, while we're on the topic, and you brought it up, here in the last week at the major league level, two firings that I got to be honest, Bill, Joe, you guys jump in. I got to tell you, when you look at who they are, I'm quite surprised that both Joe Girardi, who had fantastic success, obviously, as we all know, with the New York Yankees, has had moderate success in Philadelphia. His team, his players did not play. I mean, let's be honest about it. outside of Bryce Harper, their biggest stars have stunk up the joint. They're the worst defensive team in baseball. I don't think there's any doubt about it. And yeah, they've got some guys playing out of position because of injuries, and Harper's hurt, and, you know, can't play defense, all that kind of thing. Segura's out for 2-3 months. Heck of a player. And then Joe Maddon. Now, I know you know that situation there really well, Billy. This was a guy that worked his tail off in nobody knew who Joe Maddon was for 2 decades working for the Angels. He goes to Tampa. He goes to Chicago. They're in a boat race to get him into Anaheim, and now they cut him loose.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'll circle back to Joe Maddon, but Joe List might want to know that his Red Sox got him fired. I think the owner figured, hey, these Red Sox are so bad. If we can't beat them, he's gone. So I think that might have had something to do with it. So Joe can think on that for when we circle back to Joe Maddon. But on Joe Girardi, you know, I don't know him like you do. Would you say that he's pretty intense?
Well, there's no doubt. But I mean he's an intense, you know, he's a Midwestern, small town, tough, smart, went to Northwestern, got 2 degrees there. But he is a tough guy and demands accountability. And, you know, Billy, we've talked about this so many times. And we talked about it with Pete Rose. We talked about it with Charles Barkley a couple of weeks ago here on the show. It seems like now Buck Showalter would be an exception to that. The Mets brought in this veteran guy and he's always held people accountable. If they're not playing well. But it seems like, you know, that guys that really want to hold guys accountable are few and far between anymore. I mean, yeah. You know, you watch some of these press conferences of the managers, and these teams getting their asses kicked 12, 15 times out of an 18, 19, 20 game schedule, and they're talking about how hard they're trying all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, he kind of compares for me to Terry Collins, you know. I don't know if you remember him, but I was with him in Anaheim and I remember before he went to the Mets, we talked about it. He said, you know, I got to change some things. He said, I know what I'm doing is right. And I know it's righteous the way I approach this, and that I am demanding and I make him accountable, but I got to figure out another way to do it. And so I watched him with the Mets kind of change the way he handled players, just, you know, spend time with them every day. And I was so proud of Terry, you know, for having done that, because he had 2 jobs. This was his third. And he made an adjustment. And it's hard to make that adjustment later on in life. And I think, you know, I think Girardi strikes me as real, real good. There might be an adjustment or two he needs to make. And I think if he's willing to make those, he's probably going to be a real good manager. I'm not sure that he's done. I think he's going to get another opportunity. At least I hope he does.
Yeah.
On Joe Maddon, you know, I will say back on Joe Girardi, his team defensively is horrible. And that's not something Dave Dombrowski just got surprised by. He knew what he was doing. It was a calculated risk. You know, I need to put some offense together. I'm going to take a chance and put together some guys that might not be the best defenders. I like their young kid at third base, though. I do like that kid. Yeah. But they when Bryce Harper got hurt, that's when you realized, oh wow, we really don't have anybody that can catch a cold. So that's it's going to be a long road for these guys. I think I don't think there's a magic bullet there, you know, for them. I do think every time you change a manager, there's a little bit of tension that gets released. You know, and so I think that's what's happening in Philadelphia. But I still don't think they're going to pick up a ball and throw it. And I don't think they're going to shut clubs down in the middle innings. Maddon, I think that, you know, I've known him for so long. I was the farm director in Anaheim. He was our field coordinator. We're dear friends. You know, the one thing I will tell you is he is genuine. If you think he approaches things in an odd way. Yeah, he does. He always has from day one. And I think just knowing the cast of characters in Anaheim, I think he was the they just didn't want to see the way he approaches things, which is, you know, and he has told so many players through the years, look, Thom, Joe, if things are tough, hold on, try, it's time for you to try easier. You know, that was one of his big things.
Right, easier.
You know, and so players are always pressing. You really think they need one more guy hammering on them? So I think his approach has always been genuine, that in that he wants his players to be their best self and be relaxed. And I guarantee you, I wasn't watching him, but I'm going to bet you a lot of money he was doing his best work in the last 12 days. He's always the best when times are tough. But I do think that it's a flawed roster. I think, you know, obviously who doesn't like Mike Trout? He's great.
Yeah.
I think they've seen their best days of Mike Trout though. And I think, I think he's always going to have some great periods where he's just terrific. I'm not sure you're going to be able to keep him on the field all the time anymore. I'm not a Mike Trout hater. I love this guy. So all of you that are listening and you think I'm ragging the guy, I'm not.
It's reality. I think you're not seeing anything that people that watch it regularly don't know.
I think they've seen their best, but I will also say I'm not sure Rendon's going to stay on the field either. And I do suspect that he's done a really good job with the starting pitching. I do think that he deserves a lot of credit for Ohtani doing what he's done as a pitcher and a hitter. I think that took a lot of guidance and a lot of patience and a lot of guts. So I think there's some great stories about Joe. I hope he gets another shot. But unlike Joe Girardi, I don't think Joe Madden has to change a thing. I think he's going to get another shot if he wants it. I mean, he's 68 years old. I'm not sure if he wants it, you know, truly wants it. But I do the one silver lining is that, you know, I'm a Phil Nevin fan too. And so I really am rooting for them. I was rooting for the Angels with Joe. I'm rooting for the Angels with Phil. So I do hope things work out well for him.
Joe, you follow the Red Sox, obviously quite closely, been a fan your whole life. We know what Alex Cora has gone through the last couple of years. You know, as a fan, you know, what are your thoughts bringing in a young guy like that who basically just got off the field not all that long ago?
I love it. I mean, I always thought a young player, I mean, I was like in the Jason Veritek camp, which I don't even know if he wanted to be a manager or what he wants to do with him. But it felt like those kind of guys, as soon as he retired, I was like, let's keep him in the dugout, you know. So it just seems like Cora is such a great player's manager and a great cheater. So I love him. But my question too is, when, first of all, Buck Showalter will always be able to work because of his great work on Seinfeld. Great cameos on there back in the day. But my question, maybe for Bill, I guess, is, so when a manager gets fired, is it a crazy scene? I'm picturing like Ricky Vaughn in Major League. Do they whip a ball off the locker and knock stuff over? Or is it more like you know, Bull Durham when you've been cut loose and it's sad? Is or in between?
No, I think it's more sad. You know, it would probably be easier if they did throw stuff at you. But the bottom line is you know, nobody wants to fire anybody and nobody wants to get fired. And I do believe Joe that he was surprised. You know, I think Joe Girardi thought there might be something there. You know, writers were talking to him about it all the time. Joe Madden, I think he was really surprised. So I think it was both in those cases. Doesn't matter if you're surprised or not. It's still a sad moment. But it would, you know, having, I've been on both ends. I've been fired twice and I've fired a manager twice. So I've seen it both times and neither time did any of us throw anything.
Yeah, right.
I wanted to though, but I didn't.
Sure. I'm a big hockey guy, and the Bruins just unjustly fired their coach Bruce Cassidy, and reports are he's just devastated. And
I saw that was a surprise, wasn't it?
Yeah, he's won the second most amount of games while he was a coach. Not to change sports, but staying on the topic of being fired, which I might get fired after this because of my background. We'll see.
So did that happen because they didn't go deep enough in the playoffs?
I guess, and there's got to be a scapegoat, but it's an insane firing, and I'm livid. And by the way, I changed rooms. I got Bruce Springsteen as my background now.
Oh, nice. There you go.
Perfect.
I don't know if we have to pay him.
That's right. You're right around. You're in the hood, roughly. All right. Let's get back to the Pioneer League real quick. Zach Van Arsdale from Syracuse University checking in, telling us what's going on around the league, who's hot, who's not. Zach, what's happening?
How are you, Thom?
Good, buddy. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty well.
Where are you tonight, Zach?
I am currently in my house at in Philadelphia. Yes. So, yep. All right.
Well, were you bummed out Girardi getting fired?
I mean, I'm a Red Sox fan, same as Joe here. So, you know, we are the reason Joe Madden is gone. So I'm pretty fired up about that. But a lot of my friends are happy that Girardi is gone. So,
okay. All right.
I don't know. All right. Mixed feelings. But yeah, so who's hot? I guess we'll start with the Billings Mustangs. Yep. They're featured in our game tonight. They're coming into tonight on a 7-game win streak. They're outscoring their opponents 71-26 in this 7-game win streak. They're batting .320 as a team. Mm. And, you know, some of their guys that are helping lead the team are Jacob Kline, Mitch Pytnik, Gabe Wirtz, and Jalen Garcia. They're all having tremendous years so far. But not only has the batting been good for Billings, their pitching has also been phenomenal. Their strikeouts per nine are at an outstanding 11 strikeouts with a team ERA of 3.39, which is the league best over the last week. So they're playing tonight in our featured game. As I said, they're playing the Missoula Paddleheads in the first of a 3-game set. So that's, you know, who's hot. Another team who's hot, the Great Falls Voyagers. So they got two pitchers back-to-back weeks winning player of the weeks, Hunter Dolander and Montana Quigley. Hunter Dolander was actually just signed by the Chicago White Sox earlier this week, so that's pretty cool news.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had a phenomenal start to his season in the Pioneer League. He started 2 games with 2 wins, 13 and one-third innings, 12 strikeouts, and a 1.35 ERA. And his partner, Montana Quigley, who won this past week, he's appeared in 6 games. He's 3 saves, 7 innings pitched, and 7 strikeouts. So, you know, 2 pretty impressive stats. For those guys, a quick little fact, Hunter Dolander's brother, Chase Dolander, is actually the Friday starter for the Tennessee Volunteers. So we will most likely see him pitch this weekend against Notre Dame. So I think that's pretty cool for college baseball fans out there.
That's very, very cool. That's great stuff. As a matter of fact, Montana Quigley, what a name for the Pioneer League, right? We're going to have an interview with him. Hayden caught up with him a little bit earlier on in the week. Now, this past April, you know, a lot of people have asked us since we started doing this show, have asked me about, well, the Pioneer League and it's independent and, you know, where are they finding the players and all this kind of thing. Well, back in April, the Pioneer League had a very successful 3-day tryout camp that was held in Tucson, Arizona. And it led to 25 players ultimately being drafted by the teams in our league. Now, it was announced just yesterday that the Pioneer Baseball League is going to conduct another tryout camp that will follow the Major League Baseball draft. Remember, there was a time in the Major League Baseball draft, I think Mike Piazza was the 61st round pick. And I mean, used to go 61, 62 rounds. That's not the case anymore. You only have a handful of rounds. And then you got stuff like this. This opens up roster spots for the stretch run of this season. The PBL midseason tryout camp and draft will be at the Boise Hawks ballpark. That's Boise Memorial Stadium in Boise, Idaho. The dates, July the 30th and the 31st. Each of the 10 teams in the league has committed to drafting 2 players for either the 2022 roster, the remaining part of this year, or an invite to the spring training camp each team will hold in 2023. Now, the Pioneer League's baseball director of baseball operations, he's done it all. He's worked in the league. He's played in the league. And now it's a pleasure to finally meet you, Aaron Bond. I've heard so much about you. How you doing?
I'm doing good, Thom. Thanks for having me on the show tonight.
Absolutely. What's happening with you? You doing all right? I mean, and I say this sincerely. You got a great smile, million-dollar smile. Hell, I wish I looked like you. But you know, you just stopped playing. You got let go a couple of weeks ago while we were out there in Montana. On a serious note, how are you doing not playing?
It's tough a little bit just seeing everybody out there, all my friends out there playing still. It's tough out there, but I think I made the right choice. I had a good long career, 5-year professional career, and I think I'm ready to take this next step.
All right. Tell us about the next tryout camp. What's it like?
Oh, the Pioneer League recruits a number of players from the tryout camps we conduct both in preseason and in midseason. If you're a pro-level player with less than 3 years of professional experience, then it's really worth giving a shot at getting drafted by one of our clubs.
Billy?
Yeah, you know, the you mentioned something earlier, and really people need to hear that players get signed out of here. There's a lot of these tryout camps across the country, but clubs aren't committing like the Pioneer League clubs are committing to signing players. Now they're still looking for that young player, you know, so they're still looking for that young prospect where they can develop them, and hopefully get them to a major league organization. But the fact that they're going to, I think you said they're going to commit to two per Pioneer League team. That's a lot of players getting signed, and you're not seeing that at other tryouts. So I think, look, I saw it work last year in Ogden. Some good players got signed out of that. Some good players that are still playing now. So I do think there's something to this thing, and I really do like the commitment the clubs are making, and that really makes a huge difference.
All right. Want to thank you, Aaron, so much for joining the program this week. And we'll be checking in with you regularly. I know that, you know, we are excited to have you on with us regularly as sort of a weekly contributor. So good luck with everything. We'll continue to check back in as we move through the show on some of the things going around the league with you. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you guys for having me tonight.
We talked about the name, and here we are, right? In Montana, our featured game tonight, Billings against Missoula. But how about the name Montana Quigley? That's this dude's real name. And he happens to be the best relief pitcher right now for the Great Falls Voyagers. And one of our correspondents from Syracuse, Hayden Wasserman, had a chance to catch up with the man known as
the league leader in saves. You know, what do you feel like been going really well for you to start the season? You've yet to give up a run yet. Is there anything going particularly well for you?
I think from a team standpoint, we've been doing a great job of putting a lot of runs on the board, getting ourselves in these winning situations. We've had some great defensive plays as well, and we're just being aggressive on the base path. So we're putting ourselves in some good positions.
100 miles east of Missoula, there is a town called Quigley, Montana. I want to know if you've ever heard of it or if you've ever been there before.
Yeah, I've heard of it before. It's definitely now on my bucket list to go there before I leave Montana.
You attended a PBL tryout in Arizona, and you were subsequently drafted to the league. I was wondering what your experience was with that, how it helped you to get you to where you are today.
Yeah, it was a great experience to, you know, be back on the field with a lot of competitive guys that came from really all over the world to that tryout. And it was a good tryout, good exposure. All the teams were there. And I was lucky enough to end up in Great Falls after.
Starting with the PBL, you worked at Data On as an account manager. I was wondering how it was, you know, balancing a full-time job and also still training for baseball after, you know, you finished college.
Yeah, it wasn't easy. Sometimes you don't get to do as much baseball as you'd like, but it's, you know, it's a lot better now that I'm able to focus on one thing at a time.
What part been about playing for the Great Falls Voyagers thus far?
Just the whole organization, Tommy Thompson, the coach, and the front office, and all the players have been just very supportive of everyone. I could tell that everyone's there to watch and help everyone else.
It's Montana Quigley. I'm from the Great Falls Voyagers. There's going to be a mid-season Pioneer League tryout July 30th and 31st at Boise, Idaho at Memorial Field. Scouts from MLB and Pioneer League will be in attendance, and there's going to be 20 players drafted into the Pioneer League. Have fun and compete out there. It was a great experience going to the tryout for me a few months ago. It got me in Great Falls.
All right, good stuff, fellas. Hayden, thank you very much. And if you're interested in trying out, in signing up for the tryout camp, go to pioneerleague.com. Really easy. Pioneerleague.com. All right, let's go ahead and check in with our game correspondents and what's going on. Carter Lewis, let's start with you. You've got the Glacier Range Riders in Great Falls. What's happening there, my man?
Yeah, so right now it's the top of the third inning, and the Glacier Range Riders are up 6-0. The Great Falls Voyagers just made a pitching change from Alexander Castro to Tyler Nauman, And so far, it's been all Glacier. Ben McConnell is 1-for-2 with a double and an RBI. Gabe Howell is 1-for-1 with a double, a walk, and a run. It's been going all the way for Glacier so far.
All right, Carter, thanks so much. Hayden, let's go back to you. Billings and Missoula are featured game tonight. How you doing, Hayden? You're in Milwaukee tonight, is that right?
That is correct.
You all right, my man. Billings,
they're
back.
Killing the Brewers tonight, so you know, they were doing poorly, but I guess that, you know, firing has helped, at least right now, against my struggling Brewers. But as for the game,
did you just run your hands through that hair?
I did.
Joe, what do you think about that hair this guy's got?
Well, it the way it clashes with the background that I don't have, it's really funky. It's trippy. I feel like I'm on acid again.
Yeah,
I
mean, it messes with me too, man. It's not.
All right, Hayden, I wish I had that hair.
What's like I said, Thom, I'm going to end up like you in 20 years, man.
No, you won't. Not with that head of hair, brother.
All right. So today, Billings takes on Missoula. In Missoula, it's Teacher Appreciation Night. So the first 400 teachers to come got in for free. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, very cool.
So as Zach said earlier, Billings is on an incredibly hot streak. They started 0-3, and they've won their last seven. And a big part of that is Gabe Wirtz, who is currently leading the league in home runs with 6. And also is leading the league in slugging with a .923 slugging percentage, which is better than Barry Bonds' 73 home run season. So is he better than Barry Bonds? That's up for you to decide. But, you know, he's having a great year nonetheless. And currently Billings is up 2-0 in the top of the second. So that's off a RBI single by Jacob Klein and a Cruz Taylor home run, which I thought was an awesome name. So I thought I'd put that in there for sure.
That is. That's an awesome.
Yeah, it looks like they're continuing their hot streak today. And, you know, we'll see what they can do. And I'll let you guys know a little bit later.
All right, look at that backdrop, that field. That is fantastic. All right, Matthias Altman-Kurosaki covering Northern Colorado in Ogden, Utah. That's where Billy Bavasi is on his way to Ogden. What's going on there, Matthias? How are you?
I'm good, Thom. Of course, pleasure to be with you guys all tonight. Right
where
now,
are you tonight, Matthias? What town you in?
I am actually in Syracuse. I'm finishing up my master's program. We have about 3.5 weeks left. So
that's awesome. Congratulations.
I'm still here in Syracuse. Thank you. Awesome. Anyways, here's what's happening in Ogden right now. So in the top of the first inning, Northern Colorado got on the board first. Alex Jackson, singled and then stole base and then scored on a Brandon Crosby RBI ground out. So they took a 1-0 lead. Then in the bottom of the second inning, Jesus Valdez hit a monstrous 2-run home run to put Ogden up 2-1. Scoring Reese Elesciades. Then the top of the third inning, sort of the same deal, more manufacturing runs for the Owls. Cameron Feltz singled, then stole a base, then advanced to third on a pass ball. Then Brandon Crosby again, RBI double, 2-2. And then in the bottom of the third, Anthony Ray got on with a double. Josh Broughton singled, and then Reese Elesciades an infield single. And the throw was bad, so another run scored. So right now, Ogden 4, Owls 2, bottom 3.
All right. Matthias, thank you. Austin Murphy, you've got the Boise Hawks at the Grand Junction Rockies. What's happening there tonight?
Hey, guys. How are you guys doing?
Where are you tonight, my man?
I'm out of Kingston, New York in the beautiful Catskill Mountain area.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. Nice.
Anyways, so we got the 4-8 Hawks taking on the 3-8 Rockies tonight. Definitely not the start that either club was hoping for, but in my opinion, this is the perfect chance for both clubs to get back into the season standings. It's only the second game of a 6-game series between the two. So if one team can step up this week, they might be back in the division race by the end of the weekend. But records aside, both teams have their fair share of star power. Nico Popa of Grand Junction, player of the week last week, over a .600 batting average and 10 RBIs that last week alone. But he was cooled off quickly last night by Boise pitcher Mitch Lines, who put up 7 innings pitched, 5 hits, just 1 earned run and 9 strikeouts, quietly putting together a great campaign. 3rd in the league in strikeouts, 8th in ERA. Boise got a 9-2 win last night, but tonight, so far, just Grand Junction. Boise with an RBI ground out, two of them actually, before Josh Elvira put up 4 RBIs on a bases, 1 RBI for him, 4 for Sean Ross, a bases clearing triple, and a solo home run in the third. The score is 6-4 heading into the top of the 5th right now.
All right. Thanks a bunch. And last but not least, of course, he's been with us all 3 weeks. Owen Trainer, nice to see you, my friend. Where are you tonight?
Hey, guys. I'm in Marlboro, New Jersey, in my home.
Yes, indeed. All right. Well, what's happening tonight? You're following Idaho Falls, the Chuckers taking on the Rocky Mountain Vibes, right?
Yes, sir. So the Idaho Falls is coming in at 9-3, winning their last two, and Rocky Mountain is actually 1-11, and they're on a 10-game losing streak. So Idaho Falls has had a really good offense so far. They're leading the league in batting average, total bases, and they're tied for first in home runs and extra base hits. While on the other hand, Rocky Mountain is last in ERA, walks allowed, and the number of players caught stealing. So as of right now, we're in the top of the fourth, and the score is 12-0 for Idaho Falls. The Vibes have had four wild pitches and three errors so far. Their starter only went 2 2/3 innings and only had three earned runs. So a lot of trouble in the field for the Vibes. And that's pretty much it.
All right. Thank you so much. We'll be checking back in again a little bit later on. You know, there are a couple of new managers in the league this year, and the Northern Colorado Owls have a familiar name for those who follow Major League Baseball as their manager, Corey Snyder. Remember when he came up in the big leagues with the Cleveland Indians, played 9 years, five different teams, the Tribe, the White Sox, the Blue Jays, and then there at the end, the Giants and the Dodgers. Then after hanging him up as a player in 1994, he started working in the Mariners organization, was a hitting coach at AA, moved up to their Totoma Club and AAA for a couple of years. Then he ends up going to the Mexican League. He goes to the Chinese Professional League as a manager before he returned to baseball again and taking a role in the front office at Ogden 2 years ago. When we were in Billings, we had a chance to visit with Corey Snyder. Well, Corey, I got to ask you, you know, you have made a lot of stops along the road in this managerial coaching career of yours. I mean, you have seen some unbelievable places. What was the Taiwan thing like?
I mean, it was awesome. I mean, it's just, you know, a different part of the world. I mean, it was great. I mean, the players were really good at a certain level. There's not a lot of them there. There's only four teams. So they got four major league teams and four minor league teams. But the people there are just unbelievable. The Taiwanese people just love their baseball. Just incredible fans. I really enjoyed it. It was just tough being gone from your family for, you know, 10 months straight at a time. That was probably the toughest part. But the way they do it, the manager has to do a lot of stuff. He's got to do the draft. And it's weird how they do it also is all the rainouts, there's no doubleheaders in it. So they play them in the middle of the first half and the second half. And you have to play them on the same days that you had the rainout for the fans. Everything's for the fans. There's nothing wrong with that because the fans are unbelievable. Great people. I really enjoyed my time there. But it was just, you know, tough being gone for so long.
So now this opportunity comes along. You had connections through this whole thing already. And what's it been like? I know we're only, you know, less than a week into of the season. What's it been like so far here?
You know, it's been good. It's just, you know, you kind of get back into, you know, the players that are coming out these days. They're different players. They have different mentalities. But I mean, I've enjoyed it. I mean, spring training was a blast. You know, bringing, you know, 35, 36 players in and seeing how you have to whittle it down and see kind of who rises and who doesn't get it done. So it's been great. I mean, it's baseball. I mean, it's a game. I love it. I love teaching it. I love managing it. I love being in this part of it. You know, you just have to realize the level you're at and understand that and have a lot of patience there as well. So just learning that is great.
You know, it's interesting because there are very few guys out there. And Jim Rivlin and I were talking about you just a few minutes ago. There are very few guys that were really good players in their day that aren't afraid to go back and coach and or manage in the minor leagues. A lot of them want to step into big leagues and stay on those charter planes and everything, and yet here you are. Why?
You know, I love the game. I think everybody gets caught up in the business part of it. Was I a little bitter at the end of baseball? I feel like I got pushed out? Yes. But getting back in the game in 2007 in indie ball, and then going to the Mariners and then doing what I do. It's just, I have two boys. I won this in AAA with the Rockies right now. So it almost was like everybody gets caught up in the business part of baseball sometime during their career. I get it. But it's still an unbelievable game. It's a fun game and you love teaching it. So for me to give back and be able to tell these guys, look, I know what it takes to get to each level. Now, if you're willing to listen and learn and want to get better, I'm willing to do whatever it takes to help you. And that's the part that's the fun part. when you're working with a kid and all of a sudden his eyes get gigantic and it's like, I get it now. Okay, now you know that was really what makes it all worth it. So it's it's part of the game and it's baseball.
Last thing I wanted to ask you about, when you think about this whole journey for these guys, I mean, you know, you were a guy, you got through the minor leagues quick, you're in the big leagues and off you go, all-star and all that kind of thing. For these guys, being non-affiliated, independent league, for a lot of them, probably their last shot. You know, Jim talked about how hard it was to tell some of those guys, you know, it's time to go. I'd imagine that can't be any easier for you or anybody else in that position, is it?
That's the worst part about this job, is letting kids go. It's just, I mean, you get that same feeling of when I finally realized I couldn't play anymore, it was time to move on. That was the hardest day of your life. Because you love baseball, you love what you're doing, and you think there's nothing else besides baseball. And when you have to let a kid go, it's just like this is his livelihood. This is all he loves, all he dreams about. And when you got to say, you know what, there's some other kids who are just a little bit ahead of you, you know, I got to let you go. I mean, I try everything possible to kind of have teams down below me and teams above me to let kids go somewhere, give them some options.
Right.
Because I just tell the kids all the time, if you got a uniform on, you got a chance. Someday you're not going to have a uniform. I get it if you get too old or whatever it is, but I mean, Jim knows. It's the worst part about the job is letting kids go. I mean, it's a sad reality, but you know, kids that learn, kids that listen, kids that get better are the ones that are going to move on. But the ones that, in my opinion, are a little stubborn and they're stuck in their ways, you know, your next level is 9 to 5.
Yeah.
And you got to put a suit on. And you got to get up every day and do what they tell you. And it's a hard reality, but it kind of is what it is. But I tell them, you know what? Keep playing. Play as long as you possibly can. As long as you are still enjoying it and you're still learning and you still want to get better, keep playing.
Good luck to you, brother.
You got it. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. Okay.
Really enjoyed talking to him. I talked to him a little bit when he was a player, not a lot. And I think he acknowledged there that near the end, you know, he was a bitter guy about the business side of baseball. I really enjoyed talking to him. We mentioned the Owls are one of two new clubs in the Pioneer League this year, along with the Glacier Range Riders. Both clubs are building brand new ballparks, and they're going to be spectacular. And we're going to check in with some of the owners of the team. And let's start with the Owls. Why not? Owner Jeff Katowski. Jeff, welcome to the Roundup Show. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. So far, so good. What are your thoughts so far in the year?
Well, so far, I think we should play all our games at home. I think we won them all at home and lost them all on the road. So I'm gonna talk to the league about that, see if we just stay in Colorado the rest of the season.
Hey Jeff, you know I know you were previously you were with the Owls in Orem, Utah,
right.
And tell us a little bit about you, your background, and how you ended up in Windsor and your new complex there also.
Well, that's
a lot in the mouthful right there. Right?
I know I'm going to do it shorter than that, but I'm a baseball freak, and we bought the Owls in 2004. And we moved it from Provo to down the street to Orem. So from BYU down to then UVSC, now UVU, built that park down there. Really time was running out for us, on our lease and some other things in Utah, but really I always wanted to build a youth sports facility. That was the intention when we bought the team, with my then partners as well. Most of the partners were guys I coached Little League with the kids. And it just ultimately didn't work out for us in Utah. It was too hard to put together. Through a lot of trial and error over about 18 years, we found a home in Windsor, Colorado to build a 118-acre youth facility that has professional sports with it. It's one of a kind. There isn't a youth facility in the country that has professional sports. Not only do we have the Owls that we moved from Utah to Windsor, but we have a men's soccer team in the USL, the Hailstorm, who is in the halftime of their opening game at home tonight, actually right now.
Now, your soccer season, when is the USL season? What are the months?
Soccer started in February. First league game was in March. This is actually our seventh league game tonight, our first one at home. And even at home is a question mark because the facility is not built yet, so we're playing up at UNC Greeley as a home stadium this month, which is where the baseball team's playing also.
When the facility's finished, will both teams play there?
Both teams will play in the same park. You're looking at a map here, so you'll see the main stadium in the middle. It's got two hotels, both Hilton hotels connected to it, kind of like Toronto, and restaurants there, one of which we're doing with Carlos Gonzalez, the ex-Rocky. It'll hold 6,000 for baseball, almost 7,000 for soccer. So it's intended to be a dual stadium. Baseball first as a 1 and soccer as a 1A.
Yeah, that and you know, I'm looking at those fields. It looks like you have seven full fields or what is
it? We have 12 actual baseball fields of different sizes, 12 full size multi-purpose. Some of them are indoors. So if you go back to that other picture, you'll see that big dome. It's on the picture, it doesn't look like the size of what it is, but next to the stadium, you see that big white facility. That's 10 stories high. Indoor facility. It's got a full soccer pitch. Which doubles as two small baseball fields, 8 basketball courts, 16 volleyball courts, a 2-story restaurant. It's almost 700 feet long and 250 feet wide. It's one of the 3 largest air-supported structures ever built in the world. And that we'll see blown up in about 60 days or so. We'll practice in there. But that allows us to have the kids play year-round and allow the soccer team primarily to work out in the January, February timeframe. Baseball really won't need it because, you know, the weather is great 300 days a year up there. By the time baseball comes, we're ready to play outside.
And you've got a couple of hotels there. Where do you fly into? What airport do you use?
Well, Denver's easy. You fly into DIA. It's only a 45-minute drive. If you drive like me, maybe 55 minutes if you drive like you, you know, right? But or you can fly into Loveland. There's certain places you can go right into Loveland. Loveland's like 8 minutes away. And that's increasing. And I do think with 1.5 to 2 million people that'll be coming to the site a year, we'll be the second largest draw in Colorado behind the Rockies. I think that you'll see more flights into Loveland, and that's going to be a lot easier when that happens.
I'm asking those questions for our friends at Perfect Game or Prep Baseball Report, all these baseball machines that put out real good events. Your place looks like the perfect spot for great youth baseball.
Well, we'll have, thank you. We'll have all those guys. We talked to all those guys, right? They'll all be playing out there a little bit here and there. Most of the fields are 250s. They're really for 8 to 13-year-olds. We have 4 fields on site that'll work for that perfect game, that high school kid. What you don't see on that map, because it's an older map, is there's a second stadium there. So there's a full, what I'll call a D1 college stadium that seats 2,000. And that stadium will be open by the beginning of August, and we'll start playing there before Ticket Smarter Stadium is open. And that's a same size field. It just doesn't have the infrastructure that Ticket Smarter Stadium has, which has 60,000 feet of office space in it, for instance.
Yeah.
It's building in a building.
Well, it looks like you got sports heaven going on there. You've got some impressive partners that you have in your ownership group.
Well, we do. We've got, you know, part of what we want to do, not just as a marketing device, but we want to help the kids. So we have guys like Carlos Gonzalez and Ryan Spielbergs and Torrey Hunter and Brian Fuentes, and there's a bunch more guys that we're going to bring them out. You know, every week, one of those guys will be out. We'll do camps for the kids and let those kids meet. And we did that in Orem once a year. Now I can do it once a week. And it's not just because it's a draw, and it is, but like Corey Snyder, which you know, Thom just interviewed, you know, who I've known my whole life. We played ball together as kids. Having those guys who these kids can really look up to and have so much knowledge and want to teach kids, it's a big part of our program. And nobody wants to listen to me. Nobody has my baseball card, but they have Cargo's card. They've got Torrey's card, Spilly's card, Brian's card, and Hop's card, and Clint Hurdle's card, right? Guys like that. We're going to come out and teach these kids. And that's real important to what we're trying to do.
Well, Jeff, congratulations on everything.
Great thing going on there. Congratulations.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thom. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
All the best, Jeff. We'll look forward to seeing you out there later this summer.
I can't wait to have you.
Thank you. As we've noted, you know, the two new clubs. And so let's now meet the other owner of the new club, Marty Kelly, owner of the Glacier Range Riders. Marty, I hope you're checked in with us. How you doing?
Good time. How are you?
I'm doing great. Where are you right now?
I'm sitting on my deck at home here in Montana.
I was saying, you look like you're out of Yellowstone right now to me.
Could be. It could be.
Tell us something about yourself, Marty. I mean, and why you wanted to own a team turns out to be in the Pioneer League.
Yeah, well, one of those guys that never grew up, right? And always wanted to be involved in baseball. Played baseball as a kid growing up through college and even in the adult leagues, and coached my son, coached college kids. Ended up with a college league in Atlanta for the last 15 years and just thought it was the next good step. So I actually started looking at things in the New York Penn League a few years ago. And when the contraction hit and New York Penn League went away, there was the opportunity in Montana. We've been coming out here for 22 years. We got our second home here and it's been a great fit.
You know, I've been all over Montana, and everybody tells me, of course, the place, the area I have to go is where you have your team right there, the Kalispell Whitefish area, where I've never been to that part. I mean, mm-hmm. It's just spectacular, and you're right there basically at the entrance to the Glacier National Park, right?
You got it. We are probably 40 minutes from the Glacier Park gate entrances. You know, it's just a fantastic area. There's unbelievable golf in the area. You got all the lakes in the area. So there's a lot of summer activities and there's a lot of winter activities too. We have a very, really nice ski hill right here too.
Mm-hmm. And at your ballpark, everybody talks about it. How's it coming along? I hear it's going to be just spectacular.
It's coming along well. We're pretty close to where I thought we would be. I always would like to be a little further along, but the turf is all in, the lights are in, putting up the netting here today. We got opening day on Tuesday. I think you got a picture of it right there sitting in the stands. That's before the seats were put in. The seats are now in. So that's this morning at about 6 o'clock, 5:30, 6 o'clock this morning with the sun rising in the background there.
Boy, is that nice. And so, you got your son involved in this thing. Chris has actually been the guy leading the development of the ballpark, right?
Yeah, he's spearheading the whole thing. He's moved up here back in October and has stayed with the whole construction process with the architects and has kept everybody moving.
I got you. And the season so far?
So far, season's going well. We started out well. You know, you'll learn things as each week goes by. We got to get deeper in pitching. But the season's going well. The guys are enjoying it. They've been on the road for the first couple of weeks. This is their third week on the road. So it's been a tough road trip for them. But they'll be home on Sunday evening. And then they get a few games at home. We got a 9-game homestand. So they'll be ready to go on Tuesday.
Well, Marty, great having you on the show and great to meet you, and want to wish you the obviously the very best of success with your new team and the new ballpark over in the Flathead Valley of Montana. Thanks for taking time to join us tonight.
You got it. Look forward to seeing you. Thanks.
All righty, Marty. Marty Kelly. And Joe, you're going out that neck of the woods sometime soon, right?
Yeah, just a couple of weeks. I think I'm going to be there July 5th and 6th, and maybe even the 4th. They have a fantastic fireworks display, so I've heard. Or maybe I'm just being told that to get me to go there. But I can't wait, and I was already excited about it, but this just looks unbelievable. And I believe I'm going to be embedded with the team. I'm going to put on a uniform. I really feel like they might be tricking me because – like they're reading my diary, because this is my greatest dream come true. I'm going to wear a uniform, sit in the dugout, take BP, and I feel like I might make a team, honestly. I feel like I don't want to sound like a jerk, but I feel like some of you guys might not be realizing what an athlete you're working with here. I feel like I'm really going to turn some heads.
You'll be turning heads. I don't doubt that for a second.
No, I'm really excited. I'm making the trip. I think my wife's going to come along, and I really can't wait. I love the game, and this is like my last. I'm 40 years old, so I feel like I still have a chance to do something impressive.
And now, speaking of, turn a little more serious note. You have, you mentioned the 4th of July. You've got a movie coming out on July the 1st that is called 4th of July, which you co-wrote with Louis C.K., right?
Yeah, so we wrote this movie last year, or during COVID, sort of in lockdown, and we made it last year, last August, on Lake George, another spectacular place. And we shot some right here in Astoria, Queens, in the apartment I'm sitting in, and it's sort of autobiographical. It's about we made it, me a jazz piano player, but it's about a jazz piano player. We didn't want to do comedy. Who moves to New York City to pursue the arts and has to go and confront his family, and hijinks ensues on a 4th of July vacation. And it'll be out July 1st, select theaters, and streaming down the road at some point. And we're doing a big premiere here in New York, June 30th at the Beacon Theater, with very limited tickets available. We've sold a lot. So I'm very, very excited. I think it's a good movie. I just watched it. It's hard to watch your own work, obviously, yeah. But I think it's a funny, small movie that everyone relates to. Everyone that's part of a family will relate in some way, I think.
Well, I understand. I mean, I feel like I'm showing my age here. Johnny Carson or Letterman or whatever, which you've been on those guys. You've been on Letterman's show. You've been on Conan O'Brien. But I understand we have a trailer. Can we check that out?
Oh, that would be great.
Yeah.
I had the thing again where I thought I ran over a guy.
Did you run over a guy?
No. I was on the phone, which I know is bad. I shouldn't have done that.
Who were you on the phone with?
My mother.
You coming up on what, 2.5 years?
3 in November.
Listen, you show up late, I haven't heard from you, you're teetering. Either lean forward, take the next step, or lean back, fall down a flight of stairs. When do I get to that point?
Well, I've been sober about 3 years.
No, I'm talking to the point where I'm speaking in bumper stickers.
I'm going to Maine on Tuesday. I'm going alone. I have to go and confront my parents and say all this shit that's been destroying me. I have to go say it, it's time.
All right, sounds good.
Going home sober, always tough. The folks will push your buttons. Hell, they can install them.
Hey, needle dick.
Stop.
You and I are killing this bottle tonight, kid.
I don't drink, huh? Kevin.
No. Smell that.
How are you his uncle? You guys look the same age.
We were drinking buddies since we were 10 and 12, but he's a quitter.
Hey, Mom, Dad, I need to talk to you guys.
So talk. Here we are.
I've been grappling with some issues. I wanted to talk about, you never showed me, like, love.
Sorry, honey. What?
Play nice, everyone.
I am.
How dare you?
Perhaps if you'd been a better wife.
Knock it off.
All right.
Dude.
You take it too far.
Oh, shut up. Who's asking you?
What's the family stuff you're going to? What's happening?
They're drunks. They're assholes. Honestly, I can't even believe I'm in this family.
Every time you go to Maine, you say you're going to confront your parents. And when you come back, you always tell me that you're having too good a time and you didn't want to ruin it.
You don't think I'll do it?
I hate it here. What kind of people are you? What kind of people are we?
Bro, you got to make this right. I get you working out your thing, but just go say you're sorry.
I'm not sorry, Mark.
By the grace of heaven, you're in this family, and we know, like every chick you welcome home to roost, we know that when your foolish dreams leave you dry, it's your family you will need.
That was crazy.
Which part?
And this looks fantastic.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, it's like I said, it's hard to watch your own stuff, but I think it's pretty good. I don't know.
I mean, there's some great lines in there just in that trailer. Yeah. I can't wait to see it.
Oh, thanks. Oh, I appreciate it. I'm excited. Hopefully people don't hate it too much. And but yeah, I'm excited. We had a great time making it. It was the time of my life, and I'm looking forward to people getting to see it. I don't know if I'm looking forward to my mother seeing it, but I'm looking forward to everyone else.
How long is a production like that? How long did that take you to do?
We did it very, very quickly. We did it a lot faster. It was very low budget. Louis funded it himself with his own money, with like a bank loan. So I'm hoping it makes some money back. But we shot the whole thing in about 20 days, 5 days in New York, really? And about 15 days. But that's much, much faster than a normal movie would shoot.
Wow. I'm excited for you.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I'm excited for him too. That's going to be great stuff. All right, Billy, I think you have the next one of the owners of one of the other clubs that we have in Dave Baggett. Billy, is Dave there?
I'm here, guys.
Hey, Dave, how you doing?
I'm good, sir. How are you?
Doing great. The owner of the Ogden Raptors.
Yes, sir. I have to tell you, I saw the trailer too, Joe, and I was, it reminded me of being the youngest of four boys and all jocks. And I don't know how my parents survived because it was just absolute bedlam. And everything I watched in that trailer just took me back to my, my younger days. So it's, I wish you good luck with it.
Oh, thank you. That's good to hear. Yeah. I hope everyone can relate.
My mother used to say that we had a nice house, but the kids broke it. Hi, Billy.
That's what Bags and I have in common. We're both the youngest of four boys. Yeah. I just don't know how I survived it.
Your family was successful. That's the difference.
Oh, stop it. Jeez. Hey, so you look terrific as always. Are you are you home tonight or on the road?
Yeah, we are. I also double as the PA announcer, so I've got my GM doing it for a while, and he's hacking it up right now. And they just spit the bit with him behind the mic, and now we're down 5-4 in the fourth.
Well, you as the PA announcer, you always made a lot of friends, like Thom Kochman. He was a good friend of yours, right?
Yeah, Tommy, yeah. Not at first. Thom and I did not get along at first.
Did you end up getting along?
Oh yeah, turned out to be fabulous friendship. Even today, we'll still talk a few times. And you know, that guy could take nine of the worst players in the planet and turn them into a winning team. So nothing but respect for TK. He's a heck of a manager.
Yeah. No, you're like the Thom Kochman of GMs there, though, in the Pioneer League. You run such a great operation there, and it's such a fun place to go. Great downtown, easy to get to. How are the things going at the beach club?
Fantastic. We've got a special going on tonight. You get you pay for one steak. We give you a piece of salmon for free, as long as you sit down and buy something to drink and go along with it. And the O-Town Beach Club, man, even in Utah, you can get your favorite alcoholic and non-alcoholic drinks and live it up. And who can beat that view right there? It is the best ballpark view in the world.
I forgot that I forgot that it was called O-Town Beach Club. Hey, yeah. Bags, what's your most favorite promotion this year?
This year? I have to be, in all seriously, you know, we try to apply a lot of humor with what we do, but I would say tonight's promotion is the best one we're going to do all season because it has a lot of depth and a lot of meaning. We've dedicated our whole season to what's called the Live On campaign, which is for suicide prevention. And our players are wearing specialized uniforms tonight that we were selling to the public to raise money for suicide prevention. And we sold all the jerseys out before the game even began. There's about 4,200 people in the crowd right now. And we all do what we can to try to make a buck, and we try to do what we can to entertain our fan base. But if something that we can do can help save a life, but we'll never know it. But if we do it, if we can save one life, then that's worth more than any dollar figure you could ever bring into the coffers. So we're proud to do it. We've donated tickets to all the counselors with the Weber County Health Services to give away to people who are in trouble to go to the games, even on nights. Go by yourself. Make a friend. Just know that you're wanted and you're not alone, and we can beat this thing. So I'm really proud of what we're doing tonight.
You should.
On the other side of the scale, on the other side of the scale, I would say in history, my favorite promotion was IOC bribery night back in the day, when Salt Lake City hosted the 2002 Olympics and they had that big scandal. Remember the big scandal? So we did a deal where if anybody brought a written lie on a sheet of paper, they got in free. And then we had a gentleman dress up as Juan Antonio Samaranch throwing out the first pitch wearing handcuffs. So that was always a good one.
Oh, that's beautiful. That is so
Bill.
You should be proud of what you're doing there, and good for you, Bags. But you know, on the promotion side, where does you dressing up the guy to throw out the first pitch? You're used to dressing people up. What do we got? And I was told I could ask you about this. I was told it was okay. But how about your grounds crew when they drag the field in the fifth inning in the minor leagues? But what didn't we do something with that?
Yeah, a good friend of mine. Should I give him credit?
You bet.
A good friend of mine named Bill Bavasi, back in 2003, was the farm director for the Dodgers. And it was before the season started, and we happened to be out on the field. And our brand new hand drags had just shown up. So the grounds crew was out there practicing, walking the drags around the infield. And you had mentioned, if they're going to drag it by hand like that, you should put them in dresses and wigs and call them the drag queens. And so a promotion was born, and we did that for years, and we play special music to it. And we don't do it anymore. Times have changed. And we had to stop doing it. And of course it was all designed to just be fun. But sometimes, you know, society changes in the way we look at things, and we have to change with it. And we were happy to do so. And now we're just, they're dressed up as cowboys, and they go out and drag the field.
Well, we do evolve and we do get better, but it was fun while it lasted. And I wish we had a picture of these guys, because it was four heavy set guys, kind of disheveled, wearing boots and shorts. And then it was very clear they were not happy about it.
I'm glad we don't have a picture of those guys.
I love it, because the wigs were all screwed up, and the dresses were too small, and they're walking around with a cigarette.
It wasn't a good look at all, but it was fun.
Oh, I loved it. It was great. Minor league baseball. The fans got a few laughs.
Goes back, Bill. This is my, including being a player, this is my 37th year in pro baseball and our 29th year in Ogden. And this Sunday I'll be 62, and I just wondered where the time went. And it's been a heck of a ride.
You look way younger than 62. So what? Tell them about your playing background. Just give them a little bit of that.
Southern California kid, high school baseball, high school football at Servite High School, go Friars, in Anaheim, California. A couple years of college football and baseball at Long Beach, but then I decided I couldn't play both sports anymore, so I just stuck with baseball, and then I had an opportunity to play a couple years in the minor leagues in the Pioneer League, and I ended my career in Salt Lake. And that ownership asked me to if I wanted to stay and work for him. And I said, I'd do it for a year. And that was 1986. Good
do
Lord.
It for 1 year.
Yeah. I'd do it for 1 year, 36 years ago.
Yeah. Bags was a great athlete. He's not giving himself enough credit, but I'll tell you what, he's a great promoter. And, you know, I want to end this by saying, you know, the Pioneer League is such a great place to go watch baseball if you just want to watch baseball, and there's Ogden is fabulous. It's such a great little downtown. You're part of downtown there. It's a great little downtown with great places to eat, and it's a picturesque setting. It's just I just encourage everybody, if you're in the Salt Lake metro area, get on up to Ogden. It's just a great place to watch a game.
Well, I'll do you one better. I mean, look at all the people that played here. You know, Bellinger and Prince Fielder, and I mean, a couple hundred have started their careers here. Rookies of the Year, National League Players of the Year. We're really proud of what we've done. What I'm really proud of right now, though, is, you know, the last couple of years has been a very volatile world in the minor league world. And, you know, the New York Penn League went bye-bye. But the Pioneer League owners, my partners, We stuck together, and we saw this coming and said, what are we going to do to keep ourselves alive? And we did it. And I'm really proud of what we've done. And we're only going to be as good as our weakest members in the league. And right now we don't have any weak members. And I'm so proud of them. And now we've already expanded by two teams, and we're looking to expand by two more, at least by 24. I'm trying to put a team in the Logan area. Eisman's trying to put one in Pocatello, and Dave Heller's trying to go to Bozeman, and we want to grow this thing because we see on the horizon, we're going to have to keep doing this for a while. So there's strength in numbers, so we're going to have to keep growing. I wanted to ask Thom a question if I could. I know you're still there.
Yeah, of course. You bet. You bet.
Were you with the Cubs when Steve Buschel played for him?
Yes. What a beautiful guy.
Steve is a shareholder here. I went to high school with him.
You're kidding me.
Yeah. So you know, he's a fabulous guy, and I loved last week when you had Pete on there, Pete Rose, because he said some things that nobody's ever heard before, in my opinion. Yeah. And I watched the whole thing, and he talked about how he led the league with the least amount of errors in a position and never won a gold glove. Yeah. And I always thought that Steve Buschel, who third base for the Cubs. Oh, I think he led the National League 5 years in a row in fielding percentage for third basemen and never got a Golden Glove.
Yeah, there was no doubt those years it was when he had come from Texas. And he was still a pretty young player when he came over to the Cubs from the Rangers. And he was a fantastic all-around player. Defensively, I thought he was the best in our league. And there were some good guys at the time, no doubt about it. I had not seen him in bags in probably, 15 years after he retired. And I went out to the Diamondbacks, and I know he was watching his son play quarterback down there at Texas. And then he came rolling in a couple of years ago as a coach to Cincinnati.
Yeah.
And I just got I so much enjoyed, as you know. I mean, they're not a cooler guy in the world than Steve Buschel.
Far, to be honest with you, the best pure athlete of anything I've ever seen. His parents were, immigrated from Switzerland.
Yeah.
Escaped Nazi Germany and all that. And so Steve learned how to ski in the lake, in the Arrowhead or Big Bear. So he would be on the ski patrol as a teenager in between doing all the other. He was just an amazing human being, and I'm glad to call him a friend. And it was funny. I remember going to spring training to spend a weekend with him very early on with the Raptors to film a TV commercial with him so we can air. Ironically, never aired it because he was a terrible actor. but it was all jokes and games in the clubhouse, everything. But as soon as they hit the step and went out on the field, man, they were at the office. They were working, and I was always impressed by all of them. And I love Major League Baseball, and I'm pained with some of the things that have happened over the recent years, but I'd rather not look at the negative and just say, okay, we've been given some lemons. Let's turn it into lemonade and sell it for five times the price and make some money at it.
Absolutely. Well, Bag, we're wishing you the best of luck. We can't wait to get out there and see you this summer. So thanks so much for your time.
Thank you, and thanks for doing this show for us. I know.
Hey, by the way, Bags, boy, well, you were ripping your general manager earlier that he coughed up the lead. You now have the lead 7-5 as you walk back into the.
Have you ever seen what he looks like?
No, I haven't.
He's got a face for radio, that's for sure.
Well, there's three other guys right now on the screen. He got a face for radio.
No, he's a great. He's a 25-year-old kid. He's learning on the job. And I'm throwing him to the wolves. And my goal is by next year, I'll come in the morning, count the receipts, and then I'll go play golf and I'll show up at game time. That's the perfect way to run the operation.
Amen, brother. Amen.
I thank you guys, all three of you, for hosting the show and the interns from Syracuse doing the updates. And, this is just one more thing to try to help make the Pioneer League more legitimate in the eyes of others. There's a lot of other leagues out there affiliated as well that are really jealous of what's going on in the Pioneer League, including the Ticket Smarter sponsorship. And I credit Mike Shapiro and Henry Hunter and everybody involved for helping you guys get involved with the Pioneer League and try to give us some relevance. And we'll do the best we can to make you the most proud we can possibly do.
Well, you guys have been awesome. Thanks so much for your time tonight.
And I want Bill Bavasi. Thanks, guys. Bye.
Well, I'll see you. A couple of weeks ago, what a great dude. I mean, Bill, you can obviously tell you go way back with him. I mean, that's the kind of guy you want to work for, right? Or work with whatever.
We were actually in another Pioneer League city when I got the farm broker job with the Dodgers. And then Ogden came, the rumors were that it was going to be open. So we just pushed hard for it because being in LA, it's a 45 minute flight. It's then another 45 minute drive up to Ogden. But I was being real serious. I wasn't just trying to be complimentary to him. They just do a great job. Mm-hmm. It's there's good hotels across the street from the ballpark. Great restaurants. I really mean it. It's just a terrific place. If you get a chance to go there, it's a great place to go.
How far is that? You fly into Salt Lake and drive how far?
45 minutes. Okay. At the most.
Right.
At the most.
Easy ride. Easy ride.
I'll probably go down there this weekend or next week. I see they go on the road for a few days, so I won't be there for they're on the road Wednesday, so I won't be there for a home game, but I'll be able to maybe either tape some stuff, but I love going there and seeing him.
Well, a couple of weeks ago, I had the chance to go out to Missoula for our first PBL Roundup show. You guys, Joe was in London for that show. Billy, you were back home in California. But that city and that ballpark and that town, what a place. I mean, I couldn't stop talking about Missoula after I got back. And they do such a great job of marketing that team and generating excitement for their entire fan base. In fact, take a look at this, what they do out there to get ready for the season.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the best time of the year. The days are getting longer, it's getting warmer, and baseball is back. Missoula
a way to do your job, no matter how small, it's going to be huge.
I mean, that's great stuff. And the guy who really, you know, got him rolling again, there he is. We had a chance to spend a lot of time with the paddlehead owner. We were there in beautiful Missoula, Peter Davis. Peter, welcome to the Roundup Show. How you doing tonight?
Hey, I'm doing terrific. I'm sitting in front of the stadium because it's too loud inside, and we're playing our traditional Montana rivals, the Billings Mustangs. So, and the internet is not as strong as it needs to be inside. So I'm on my phone. So, but I'm here, and thank you very much, Thom.
Absolutely. So much enjoyed hanging out with you when we were there, Peter. And you're a Seattle guy, a big Mariners fan, season ticket holder, all that kind of thing.
Correct.
You owned a building products business, if I'm not mistaken. You sell that, and then you decide to buy a team in Missoula, Montana. How did all that go down?
Well, it was a long-held dream, and for 20 years, took me 22 years to build the resources, made it possible to even think about getting involved in baseball in another way besides just being a fan. And so I tried to find a Mariner affiliate we could participate with, and that went nowhere. So I called a broker for minor league franchises, and I said, what do you have available? He said, well, I have Missoula, and I have Chicago, and I have Mississippi. And I said, well, Missoula is closer to Seattle, so what do you got there? And he started to describe it, but he said, there's somebody in front of me, and we kind of had to wait until that person could not put together the package together. And actually, it was on a construction site, and they called me and said, well, it looks like it's available. And I said, what do you need? He told me, and I said, I can do that. And he said, that makes me very happy. Let me call the owners, which is the Ellis's that we bought the team from. And, he talked to the Ellis's. They said, that's great. Susan and I were there the next day, and we bought the team that night. So now, in 24 hours, it went from zero to done.
Now, I got to ask you, though, in 2019, you buy into the league. 2020 gets wiped out due to the pandemic. And then Major League Baseball decides they're taking away the league's affiliation status. That's a lot going on for a guy who just bought a franchise.
Yeah, well, I didn't know any better. So I got one season, 2019, with the Diamondbacks, the affiliation. And, really what you do when you're affiliated is you run the concessions and you sell tickets and you work the community side, but you have nothing to do with baseball.
Yeah.
Right? They do all the baseball side. And, in fact, I kept asking our manager at that point, why didn't you steal then? Why didn't you bunt? Why didn't you pull that pitcher? Why didn't you do this and that? And he said, because I'd lose my job if I did any of the above, because it's all about, what their program is, each individual player, and winning is not really why we're here. We're here to develop players. And so I thought, well, this is awfully curious. And so, the affiliation went away. When the COVID hit, and Susan and I, was like, this is a family affair. Susan and I run the team. And so we decided we're going to keep the staff throughout COVID, through anything. So we kept everyone because they loved them. We thought they were fabulous. And in the long term, this is going to be a great staff, which it's proven to be. And so we just did movies for a year. We did movies and dinners on the diamond. And then and all sorts of other, anything we could do to provide Missoula with something to do that year in the COVID. And so then the real question became, well, what's the league going to do? The key for me was, is the league going to stick together or fall apart like the Penn League did? And, we'd have conference call every Thursday. All the owners are on the call. How do we restart? And no one ever mentioned not continuing. The assumption was we're going to keep going. We're going to go on. And as long as the league was going to be there, we're going to be there. So all that was good. So that was terrific. All that was great.
I want to ask you about the name change because, I mean, how did you make that decision? And I got to tell you, I've been to every Major League Baseball park and every Major League team shop and NFL, basketball. I mean, I've been to them all. I mean, you guys, what you've put together from a straight merchandise standpoint, since that name change is staggering.
Well, we're the whole staff, we're at the winter meetings and we're discussing, they're talking about how do we bring new life to the Osprey. And there's an Osprey, actually an Osprey bird in center field because we're right on the river here. And so he fishes in the river and they only eat fish, but how do we, it's been the Osprey for years. We didn't initially start thinking we had to change the name of the team. We just wanted to refresh Osprey. And we sat around a table and we kept talking and it was going nowhere. And then the four or five of us were there just all agreed, well, we got to do something different and new. And we really wanted to do something that is pure Missoula, pure Montana, but specifically Missoula. And we spent a lot of time trying to think of how we might do that. And we're actually sitting around and a Moose brand was kind of rising to the top for us. And we're all sitting in the conference room near the offices, which are downtown, which I think you were at, Thom.
Yeah.
And so at that point, all of our phones all went off and the comment was, I don't think a moose is necessarily Missoula. But as we were saying that, and Matt Ellis, who's our president, said that, as we said that, our phones all went off and there was a moose walking through downtown Missoula. And we said, this is a sign. This is perfect.
You gotta be kidding.
No, absolutely. So that was like that tipped the thing scale. And then we worked with Brandios to do the branding and they're fabulous people. They're really fun to work with. They spent some time in Missoula and kind of understood what we're about. And the whole focus was how do we represent all the things that are cool about Missoula? And the moose doing whatever it does on the river rafting, fishing, all the other stuff really came out of all that. And it was really a huge amount of fun to do. And our team has done a fabulous job marketing it and rebranding it. It's just been fabulous.
And then you cap it off when you're finally able to play again, Peter. You win the whole thing last year.
Absolutely. Now credit has to go to both Matt Ellis and our manager because Matt, a year before all that happened, what kind of team do we want to be? We want to be a pitching strong team. We want to be a fast team. We want to be a defensive team. And hitting will come after that because that's how you win baseball. And so that kind of began the search for that. And Michael just fell in our lap because of that. He's the next pitcher and he's perfect. And we hired Michael. And before we actually formally hired him, Michael had players signed up to come to Missoula. And it all kind of, so Matt started this process early. We were ahead of a lot of people. And if you look at the beginning of last year for most of the people we play, we were way ahead in terms of thinking about how the team should come together. So that kind of gave us a jump start in June last year. And we just kind of carried that through the rest of the year until we got to August. And, whenever the team's home, Michael, Matt, and I meet for about an hour every day in the afternoon. And we're talking about the team in August. And Michael kept saying, this team can't get won't get us to the championship. And we turned over 10 players in one day. And that's the team that won the championship. The team that we hired actually put together in the middle of August. And it was extraordinary experience from there.
It's an amazing place and you do such a great job. I love that town that you're in. And obviously I know you love it too. And the way you treat your people there, that's a sense I got. For those who don't know, I mean, you went out and bought this historic house. I think it used to be a sorority house, right? Am I right on that?
It was a sorority house, and there's truly a housing, there's a rental cardinal crisis and the housing crisis in Missoula all at once. And we didn't know where we were going to put the players. And this historic house, which is not far from the house that we live in Missoula, was up for sale, and my wife Susan found it, and it was selling for the value of the land. because it's actually six buildable lots. And we couldn't see it. We couldn't stand to have someone tear this place down and build six lots there. So we just bought it, and for the value of the land, which was not a whole lot of money given what we got for it. And so now our players are staying there. They all worked out really well, and it's been just a fabulous experience. And we look for a lot of adventure when we're renovating that house some more.
Well, Peter, all the best. Thank you so much for your time. Congratulations on the championship last year, and we'll be checking in
with you
if you're able from time to time during this season.
Absolutely. We'll be here.
All right. Peter Davis, kind enough to join us. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we're going to catch up with a couple of the players, guys that are trying to keep their hopes and dreams of professional baseball alive, including a young man we met named Darian Reagans. Stick around. It's after the break.
Accept cash anymore, but I can give you Toasty tokens instead.
The smell of popcorn and hot dogs, the crack of the bat, the pop of the mitt, the roar of the crowd. Baseball is in the air. Grand Junction Rockies single game tickets are on sale right now. Be a part of the excitement and catch something fun at every game, from theme nights to dollar hot dogs to $2 drafts. For a full promotional schedule and to get your tickets, go to gjrockies.com for Grand Junction Rockies baseball. We'll see you at Saplesio Field. Get your tickets today.
All right, welcome back to the PBL Roundup Show. And listen, let's catch up on what's going on with some games around the league. And we'll go in reverse order this time. How about that? Owen Trainer, we're giving you the first shot. Idaho Falls, the Chuckers taking on the Rocky Mountain Vibes. What's going on in that one tonight?
Hey, guys. So I would say not much has changed, but that's not really the case. The Chuckers have scored 9 more runs since the last time I talked to you guys. Wow. So the score is now 21-0.
Barn burner.
21-0. They're up by 3 touchdowns.
Oh, good Lord. All right. Well, the Chuckers. Joe, you think there's a comeback in the offing there?
Absolutely, I do. If they bust out, remember MTV's Rock and Jock softball?
Oh, yeah.
They need that. They need the 8-ball. There used to be an 8-ball that you could request, and if you hit it out, you got 8 runs. We need to bring that back.
You know what? I'll bet you somebody, well, they might not go for that. I don't know.
That's a pretty good idea. I like that one.
It was fun.
All right. Austin Murphy, the Boise Hawks and the Grand Junction Rockies. Owen, by the way, thank you very much. Austin, what's happening there?
Well, this is no football game like we just saw there, but a little bit of action since we last talked. It was 7-4 when I last checked in. Since then, Tyler Jorgensen scored on an error, and Raymond Gill brought in Jacob Cruz on an RBI single, making the score 6-7, closing the gap for Boise. But Nate Scantling got his second stolen base of the game, and Nico Popa, last week's player of the week, drove him in on an RBI triple. 8-6 is our current score heading into the top of the seventh.
All right, great stuff. Matthias, what's going on in the game, Northern Colorado in Ogden?
So we got a barn burner on our hands in Ogden. So in the top of the fourth inning, after an error by Fox Simonis, Kevin Higgins hit an RBI single for the Owls. And then after that, a two-run triple by Alex Jackson made it 5-4. Three unearned runs scored by the Owls, which forced a pitching change by Ogden. Riley Ottenson came in to pitch. But then in the bottom of the fourth, Dakota Connors led off with a double. Josh Broughton hit an RBI fielder's choice. Freddie Achikar, who was the player of the week the first week, hit an RBI single. He's up to a team-leading 17 RBIs. Then after a wild pitch made 7-5, he had a bit of an injury delay because Alex Jackson crashed into the left field wall trying to catch a foul ball. The bases were loaded, and Sonny Uliana, in his second career game, hit a grand slam to make it 11-5 Raptors. Sonny Uliana, this is his second career game, and he's homered in both of them. So I think he's off to a good start. He has two homers and seven RBIs to start off his career. So top of the fifth, last I checked, the score is Raptors 11, Owls 5.
All right. Thanks a bunch, Matthias. Hayden Wasserman, Billings in Missoula, our feature game here tonight. What's happening there?
So last we checked, it was 2-0. It is now 4-2 Billings. So Jared Akins hit a home run for Missoula. That brought them within one. And then they scored on a double play, actually. So that brought in a run as well. But since then, Wirtz, who's, like I said, has been putting up crazy numbers, nearly 1,000 OPS, which is just insane. He hit a double. And there was also another home run from Jacob Klein, who's got two RBIs today. So he's leading the team. But he's been fantastic today. And all five of their top hitters all have at least one hit today, and three of them have two hits. So the top of the order is really carrying the load today, Thom.
All right, Hayden. Thanks a bunch, man. And last but not least, our buddy Carter Lewis has the Glacier Range Riders taking on Great Falls. What's happening there, Carter?
Well, Thom, so far it's cooled down a little bit, if I'm being honest. Started off 6-0 for Glacier Range Riders after two innings. But since then, Tyler Newman's came in and he's shut it down, only allowing two runs since. So it's currently 8-0. But the best pitcher so far tonight has been Brock Naughton for Glacier, who's pitched six scoreless innings so far. So right now it's the end of the sixth, and Glacier's up 8-0 over Great Falls.
All right, buddy. Thanks so much. We'll be checking in a little bit later on. You know, Billy and Joe, you're going to find this out when you go out there. Billy, I think a lot of people have a hard time understanding. Like when I'm here in Ohio, right? And I mean, we're 1,000 miles away from most of these teams. And we were there for, you know, a little over a week and a half ago out in Montana, four different cities in 7 days. But trying to get your arms around what this league is, would you say, you know, they do great promotions. We've covered that. They treat the players great, not only as a player, but as people. The host families that have a lot of these young men stay with them during the entire time. They're exposed to places that most of them have never been. Would you say this is truly a development league?
Yeah, it is and it isn't. You know, the owners, they need to put a product on the field that the fans want to see. I'm a big believer that it doesn't matter that it's professional baseball. You just have to present baseball professionally. And that's what these men and women are doing in the Pioneer League. So I for me, it's a development league because of the age they're pursuing. And so I think they understand, or I think this is their belief, and Mike Shapiro can correct us on this if I'm wrong, but you know, they want to get the younger players so that some players can go on to major league organizations and maybe on to the big leagues, but they can at least, you know, fans can identify with that and watch them as they move on. And so that I think there's some excitement to that then, as opposed to getting a player who has played in the big leagues and he's done, you know, Manny Ramirez, who was one of the best hitters of all time. Yeah. And, but he loves to play so much that he's going to play until he just can't walk anymore. And so I think there's something exciting about seeing that too, but I think it's more fun, I think, for the fans to make a connection with a young player who might continue on. So for me, it's a semi-development league, you know, Peter gave you a good picture of what minor league baseball is now at the very, very low levels. There's a real prescribed plan for each young player. And, you know, you're not – the best players are going to hit up the lineup because you want them to get more at-bats. A lot of those best players, they'll come to the big leagues, and they may not have bunted ever in the minor leagues because they're not going to go to a club that is going to bunt. And so it's a different story now with these guys. So they're trying to win ball games because they're just simply competitive. You know, they're competitive in making sure they come up with the best promotions to make the most money. They want to have, if they hear another club has better housing for their players, they're going to try and get better housing for their players. So I think it is a quasi development league. Or semi development. I do think that they want to pursue development, and they do, but they have to think of the here and now too. So it's, for me, it's really the most interesting baseball there is out there, because they are pursuing the young guys, but they are making sure that they have fun places to go watch games.
You know, Joe, I don't want to get overly philosophical or too deep on this. I'm incapable of both of those things, but you know, I'm sitting there thinking to myself when I was there and talking to some of these young guys, and I thought of you in your career and your profession, because, you know, these guys in the Pioneer League, a lot of them, this is their last shot. I mean, this is it. And if they want to stay in the game, you know, like Jim Riggleman was saying, you know, they got to keep going. And most likely, if you don't, you know, it's kind of, I mean, it's hard to be a stand-up comic. It's hard to get to the top. And you've done a lot of grinding and probably been in some places you wish you weren't along the way.
Yeah, absolutely. And it really makes me think of comedy. I think I alluded to it before. I read the book Where Nobody Knows Your Name, which I recommend to anybody. I mean, I imagine a lot of our audience has already read that book, but it's about minor league baseball and umpire and players. And I like cried. I mean, the guy getting called up to the big league, it's right at the opening of the book. I remember I was on a bus to some gig, literally sobbing, because you just relate so much, because it is that dream. And a lot of people don't make it, and you have to play for the love of the game. And it's a long road. And the difference between, you know, showbiz or comedy and baseball is I finally made it when I was 35. I started to make a good living, and 22 years in now, I'm making like a really good living. But I'm 40 years old. If I was an athlete, I'd be probably out of professional baseball, unless you're, you know, Jamie Moyer or Pete Rose or whatever. Not many people play at my age. So that's the big difference. But I certainly identify a lot with this level. And I just love it. I can't wait to get out there and watch some of these ball games, because all these ballparks are just spectacular. And I love baseball at any level. I mean, I used to go down and just watch Little League baseball in my town. I just love the game.
You know, that we met this kid. We were in a rain delay in Billings, and Henry Hunter and Jackson Shapiro and I were bouncing in and out of the clubhouse, going in there, talking to Jim Riggleman. He had a legendary baseball name from the past, a guy named Dave Bristol, who was the manager as the Big Red Machine was building in Cincinnati, and Sparky Anderson took his place. But his nephew was there to see Riggleman. They had become friends when he was in Cincinnati as a coach. And it was a really cool kind of scene. But when you start talking to some of these players, and the batting cage is right there. I mean, the fans can come watch the guys take, you know, hit in the cage. And it's a great setting for fans and little kids sitting there watching these guys they think are the big stars and everything. And we got to talking to this one guy from Baltimore named Darian Reagans. And he's a pitcher, left-handed pitcher. And he's telling us his story about, you know, he grew up in Baltimore, a pretty rough background. He went to Delaware State, which is, you know, I mean, it's good baseball, but it's not playing in the SEC or playing in the, you know, wherever, ACC. And he just has this dream alive. He works a regular job all the time, but works out every single day. And instead of me telling you about it, let me introduce you to Darian Reagans. Great kid.
Walk me through this. You finished playing college baseball. Obviously, you did very well. But then what did you do? What have you done since?
I had to go to the real world, had to get a job, wait for opportunity. So I did mental health. I was a mental health technician for about 3 years, from 2018 to 2021.
So you're getting up every morning.
Right.
And you're getting up at 6, 7 o'clock in the morning.
I work 3 to 11. In the mornings, I'm training for baseball. So from about 9 o'clock to about 2 o'clock, I'm training for baseball. Then I go to work from 3 to 11, and I get up and go to work, you know, every day. So I do that for 3 years until I got a chance to land the big buyout, and I signed up from there for the next 11.
So you, you said you were continuing to pitch, even in as many leagues as you could find, right?
Exactly.
What kind of competition was that? What's some of the stuff you saw in those leagues?
So one league, the Lehigh Valley League, that was a lot of kids that were fresh out of college. I also played in the Mark Ingram League. That was a lot of guys that are probably 30 and older, or 25 and older, that probably played professional baseball. Most of them were former pros. And a couple other leagues, I just played a couple tournaments and things like that whenever they needed me. But just pitching probably twice a week, starting twice a week.
So you've never given up, and you still haven't given up on this dream?
No shot. My mentor, thanks, Mr. Wilkbank, he taught me, if it's for you, you got to do what you need to do to make it happen. If I can breathe, I can make it happen. I'm not stopping until I don't stop breathing.
Have you ever been to Montana before?
No, this is my first time.
How is it?
That was
for a brother.
Scenic. It's scenic. I feel like a unicorn out here. Definitely feel like a unicorn. The people are great out here, though, but there's just, like this right here, we got a mountain right here. Just sometimes after the game, I just go up there and just look. I can't believe I made it here from Baltimore to Billings, you know?
It's a long way from home, man.
For sure.
Long way from home. So what's going on? Everybody sets goals. The ultimate goal is you get to get signed by a team, you get to pitch one day in the big leagues, no doubt about it.
Right.
But for right now, your goal, today, tomorrow, the next day, is to do what?
For one, I just want to inspire people just to make sure if you're doing anything that you're passionate about, just keep going. Just don't let, it's a lot of things, a lot of obstacles that I had to go through the past 3 years, COVID, of course, but just making sure that I'm inspiring people just to make sure that they keep going doing what their path is. Just trusting God, just try to love, just spread the gospel, you know? That's
the biggest thing. You seem like the kind of guy that would be able to relate to a lot of kids.
Definitely.
Right?
At the mental health hospital, I work with the kids as well, so that kind of helped me just think about life, you know, kind of, it's bigger than me, because when I was trying to make it pro, in 2018, I was kind of thinking of myself more, but the more I worked with the kids, the more I was realizing, the better I would be would just be just trying to help other people. That's when I kind of figured out the mindset I need to have for baseball. I kind of figured out my pitching style and things like that, so the more I learned to help others, the more I learned about myself.
Have you stayed in contact with any of those kids? I mean, I imagine you made some plans. They're rooting for you, right?
Well, for the kids at the hospital, I couldn't keep in contact with them, but the kids that I talk to who are baseball, training with baseball, I talk to them all the time.
Yeah, you tell them to keep it rolling?
Yeah, they inspire me, I inspire them. It's,
good luck to them. We're rooting for you. Absolutely. Good luck.
What a great kid. And you know, so many of those guys are just like you.
He's a special story for me. We my business partner and I, Bob Fontaine, we run a scout school. And for a few years, we did it in person in Arizona. And he referenced his mentor, Ben Wilkbank. And Ben Wilkbank pitched in the Pirates organization in the 70s, probably till 79. It was when free agency came about and players were becoming more sophisticated about shelf life and things like that and what they could do with their careers. But they were real tough players in those days. And I'm not saying they're not now, but they were just learning what the business was like. And so Ben came to our scout school 2 years. He came twice and great guy. And I really got to like him. He just from the era he pitched and just a good dude. And he said, you know, I'm working with some guys. And he said he was impressed with a couple of the guys that he's working with. So I said, well, you know, you can get them to tryouts. And I'm thinking about the Pioneer League or the Atlantic League or the Frontier League or the Pecos League. I said, you know, when we're done here, we'll get together and I'll get him into some tryouts. I'll get somebody into some tryouts. Ben went home after the second scout school. And the day he got home, he tested positive for COVID. And a week later, he went in the hospital and he never came out. And so I spent a lot of time talking to his wife, Juanita, and we figured out who he was talking about. It took me a while to track down this young fellow's name because, you know, I had to kind of piece it together with her. But she got to it pretty quickly and got me in touch with Darian, and he went to the tryout. The best I could do for him was get him into a tryout. So we got him into the Atlantic League tryout, and he signed with an Atlantic League team. I don't know how he got to Billings, but this kid's a special story. And I'll tell you, you know, you touched on something, Thom or Joe, one of you touched on it earlier, that these young guys, you know, they may not always end up playing, but they may end up doing something in baseball. Mm-hmm. And this is one of those guys. I hope he goes to the big leagues, but if he doesn't, I hope somebody has enough smarts to hire this guy, you know, because he's got a great background to bring into a minor league system to deal with young kids. Because I'm telling you, you know, you bring in so many young kids, we're not ready for them all. You know, we're not ready for all the personality issues or the difficulties kids go through. This kid's a special kid for me.
Yeah, I really enjoy getting a chance to meet him, and I can't wait to see him later this summer when we go back out there. All right, let's shift gears here a little bit. And Bill, you had something put together. For those that weren't with us, we had Pete Rose last week after Charles Barkley in the first week. And boy, I mean, if there is truly an American treasure that you wish you could bottle up, it's Pete Rose. There's nobody like that guy to talk to. But you went back and started comparing with some of the guys from Syracuse, what's going on since he played and the kind of player he was compared to today, right?
Yeah, well, you know, Thom, what we do is I'd love to say that I'm coming up with all of these ideas, and I'd love to say I know what I'm talking about when it comes to analytics. I don't. Look at the head. Look, you know, I'm the old guy of this group. So, but these two young guys, and we have a bunch of young guys that really know what they're talking about. So I always like to just leave it up to them what they want to talk about. And so I've got Austin Murphy and Owen Traynor. I think, Austin, are you going to lead off?
I think Owen's going to start us off.
Owen, let it rip then.
All right. So you guys had the pleasure of speaking with Pete Rose last week. So it seemed pretty fitting to look deeper into his career along with how the game has changed over time. So as you can see on this graphic, a lot has changed since Pete Rose was playing in the game. League average, batting average surprisingly stayed constant. However, there's an extreme increase in statistics like strikeouts and home runs. And overall, the game has a far more advanced run scoring environment than we have previously ever seen. So next, this is a chart that shows the entire history of the sport of baseball, Major League Baseball, which has data ranging back all the way to the 1880s. So this plot shows the average number of singles across more than a decade of Major League Baseball. Denoted in dashed lines is the Pete Rose era, and we can use this to compare the state of the game across so many years of data. And the traditional spread of the graph shows a decreasing number of singles over time. However, as the number of singles dwindles, we see an increase in the overall slugging numbers, which is denoted by the color. Instead of just batting average, a player's slugging is calculated by weighting each type of hit differently. So a double is worth 2, triples worth 3, and home runs are worth 4. So the more extra base hits a player has, the higher his slugging is going to be. This measure aims to account for more than just how often a player gets a hit, and can also be described as the number of total bases a player gets in an at-bat. Using Pete Rose as an example, he slugged 409 in his career, or said differently, accumulated about 0.41 total bases per at-bat.
All right. Well, I'll tell you
lastly,
and this is yours too, right?
Yeah. So okay. Lastly, the game we all know and love has evolved into a game where we see hitters who either strike out, walk, or hit a home run, in which seems like almost every at-bat. So from 2015 on, we can see from this table an increase in the percentage of home runs, walks, and strikeouts, which all lead to the, quote, three true outcomes we see in today's game. Strikeouts have increased, but does this mean that pitchers are better than before? They may have more velocity and break on their pitches. However, we also see an increase in the walk rates, which can also lead to the assumption that hitters might have a better eye in today's era of the game. Regardless, the baseball we watch today has a lot more players who tend to fall into this category of a three true outcome hitter, will continually be argued as for better or for worse of the league. It's going to be interesting to see how these rates change within the 2022 MLB season and the exit of the shift coming in Pro Bowl next year.
So these are pretty significant changes from 2015 to 2021. Owen, how old are you?
I'm 20 years old.
So in 2015, you were conscious enough and enough of a baseball fan. Do you like the game today as opposed to 2015? Would you rather be watching the game in 2015 or would you rather be watching the game in 2021?
It's kind of tough to say. I mean, there's a lot of excitement that some people have from the long ball that we've seen in today's game, but a lot of people can also complain about the number of strikeouts that we see. So, I mean, I don't know. I think there was definitely back in 2015, like I remember the Royals who won the World Series were not very much of a three true outcome team. They led the league in stolen bases, and it was just very different from what we see today.
You know, it's funny that it's a real different game than when I was growing up, but that really doesn't matter. But you know, I look at a team like Philadelphia and if the team that's going to do well against them is that Kansas City Royal team that you mentioned, because if you're playing Philadelphia, I would put the ball in play and make them play baseball. Make them pick it up and throw it, and they're not gonna. So it is a different game, but it's still just as interesting as it's always been. And this is some real good work you've done, Owen. Really, fun to look at this stuff. I really appreciate it. Austin, what do you got?
So what I looked at kind of builds off of what Owen just explored. What Owen noticed was that scoring as a whole has been up since Pete Rose played, but singles have been down. So these runs are coming from alternate ways. So what this graph here looks at is MLB home run rates for each plate appearance in the season since 1963, which is Pete Rose's first year in the majors. Each individual dot is a single season, and the vertical axis is the number of home runs per plate appearance that we saw that season. The shaded areas represent three different distinct eras in baseball history. Red on the left is Pete Rose's playing career. Green in the middle is the steroid era. And the blue on the rightmost end is the modern long ball era we've kind of entered into now. And then the dashed lines that run vertically across the graph are the peak home run rates in each of the three eras. So my biggest takeaway from this graph is how distinctly you can see each era just on their home run rates alone. Pete's era was much lower than the rest of them. And we all know that Pete was a great player because of his ability to put the ball in the play and reach base. And that was kind of the strategy of that time period. The small ball, get on base, try to score runs that way. Home run rates never even crossed 2.5% when he played, which is kind of remarkable given where we're at now. But once he retired and steroids kind of made their way into the game, home run percentage absolutely skyrocketed and reaching almost 3% in 2000, which wasn't even Barry Bonds' career year. But that's why we saw Bonds, Mark McGwire, Sammy Sosa dominate that time period, because teams were trying to stock up on guys who could play into the type of baseball that was going on, which was just slugging the ball out of the park as much as you can. But then as MLB started to crack down on the steroids, we saw a gradual decrease before out of nowhere a couple years ago, it spiked to well over 3%, reaching a peak of 3.63% in 2019, leading some people into speculating about whether or not MLB's tampering with the baseballs. And so building off of that, we need to first understand that MLB actually tweaks their baseballs every single season. And we can tell that because of the up and down pattern we see consistently throughout the graph. Sure, there's going to be turnover every year between pitchers who retire or batters that come into the league. So it's not going to be a consistent home run rate each season, but not to the extent that we're seeing in this graph. These are massive changes. So what's happening is MLB is saying, okay, our home run rates are too high. Let's drop it down by tweaking the ball a little bit, keeping it in play. And then they realize they went too far, bring it back up. So that's why we see up and downs every couple of years. But getting into today's era, MLB rate, home run rate reached a pretty significant low in 2014 after the steroid era, going even below Pete Rose's peak year in 1986, the lowest it had been since 1992. And after that, we see a three-year period where home run rate skyrockets by about 1.5% into 2017. And after that, it keeps going up into that peak of 2019. And now we're seeing, again, home run rate is on the way back down, making us think that this ball is being tampered with by the league and in a way that home runs are less common. So is it really possible that these massive changes happen naturally? Sure it is, but it's probably not the likely story.
This is more good work by the Syracuse group. Really appreciate it. You know, the baseball is it's a crazy thing, and I think I do believe there's been adjustments or attempts to adjust it over the last 10 years in different times, but it's I don't even know how to describe it. It's such a delicate balance, you know, and when you start messing with the baseball, whether you leave it in the roller a minute longer, you change a lot. You lower the seams just to, you know, where we can't notice it, you know, changing the baseball and then trying to change it back. And then you go too far the other way. It's too tough. And so for me, it's made by hand, generally by hand. You just got to put the specs out there and never touch it. Just never show up there. Just let the factory make the balls and just give them the same specs every year. Have some quality control. Don't try to outsmart the rest of us by making it livelier or more dead. So I don't know how much that's involved here, but I do think your work's interesting here. I was going through it the other day when you sent it to me and trying to pick out when they lowered the mound too. I always thought that's way before you were born, but that was when there were Koufax, people like Koufax and Drysdale and Gibson, and the mound was pretty high, and then they lowered the mound. Things change along the way with the rule changes, but the information you've come up with is real interesting stuff, and I know I really appreciate it. And who's up next week? Who's going to be doing this next week? You know,
I'm not sure if you decided about that, but
we'll figure it out. We'll just meet. Yeah. We'll meet tomorrow, and then we'll go on from there. We'll figure out what we want to talk about. Actually, we always figure out what you guys want to talk about. So I'm left hanging here with you guys. So what do you guys want to talk about? Have you reported on games tonight?
A couple.
Who have you got?
I got the Grand Junction Boise game.
Okay,
that's all back. Yeah.
All right. Well, Thom and Joe's back. So the Thom and Joe.
Yeah, back we're back. Best. We're back, and we're gonna. Guys, thanks a lot. That meant really a lot. Stuff.
Outstanding work.
I'm sorry, Billy. Forgive me.
No, outstanding work by the young guys.
Yeah, great job. All right, we're going to try and now maybe lighten things up a little bit. Uh-oh. Joe List, not only a great comedian and traveling all over the country and on YouTube, and he's been on Letterman and Conan O'Brien, but we've established that he's a huge baseball fan, Red Sox guy. So we're going to try, Joe, every week, this little experiment by where we put together, you're going to put together, give us a little perspective, some kind of a list of really whatever you want to do. Is that what we're going to try to do?
I think something like that. I mean, I didn't make a list this week, but I have stuff in my head. I don't know what I'm doing. I was looking at the script, and it says Joe's going to do something, and I went, uh-oh. But I think it's something we're going to attempt. I was going to try to do some play by play, which I'm highly skilled.
Love it.
But I do feel like I'm being a little bit sandbagged. I don't know if Thom is behind this, but the feed has been cutting in and out. So I don't know if I can properly do the play by play the way I want to with this feed.
You can do that right there.
All right. We're live at the ballpark. There's a couple squirrels. I mean, I got to call the squirrels.
Why not? I mean, you got to call play by play.
I mean, I think we're in between innings here. There's some squirrels, and they look at the bounce in their step. They're really squirreling it up. They got some nuts there.
Peanut inning. That's a huge deal at the ballpark there. The peanut inning, and so if they score runs, everybody gets bags of peanuts. Billy, you've seen this whole operation when they do this, and. Oh, yeah. You know, when they were affiliated with major league teams, the major league teams, from what we're told, they do not like this kind of stuff. They don't want their minor league teams having anything to do with stuff like this. But they have the data that shows, and I can't believe the Syracuse guys haven't shown us the peanut inning and the scoring results, is they score a lot more runs over the course of the year. I believe it's a sixth inning they do it. What does that say on there? Sixth inning, yeah. So this is when they do it, and this is when they score the most runs all season, pretty much every year when they play the peanut inning. Joe, take it away.
All right, we're here in the bottom of the sixth. Somebody's playing somebody. I'm not sure what teams. I don't have all the stats, all the data, but there's a fella on the mound, and he's pitching from the stretch, even with the bases empty. He kicks and delivers, and that's a ball inside. Looked good from here.
Kicks and delivers. That's big time.
Not bad, right?
Not bad. Not bad.
Infield playing him straight up, and he's let's just say he's 2 for 3 on the day. He's got a double and a single and scored a run. And I'm doing it Vin Scully style. I don't even have any color. It's all me. There's the pit. Oh, it swung on and hit somewhere. I can't F and C. Somewhere in, it looks like a base hit, and that's a single. Very difficult to see, but if I was there, man, it would have been fantastic. Kelvin Pilot is on the mound at the moment. He's pitched five, given up 2 earned runs, 2 strikeouts, and now he's got to deal with a man on first, and we're going to have a meeting at the mound.
Wow.
I mean, that's pretty good stuff, right? I mean, come on.
You know what? I got to tell you know what's funny about this show is it and you know, I get young people ask me all the time. I mean, every day somewhere about how do you practice, you know, play by play. And I tell guys all the time, and Joe, you know this in your work. It doesn't matter if you go to Baltimore City College or whether you go to Yale. If you're a play-by-play announcer, the only thing that matters is your tape. That's all they care about. They're not looking at your grade point average. Hell, they don't even care if you graduated or not. If you've got the best tape, and then the kid will ask me, okay, well, what do I do about a tape? And I said, look, if you go to your local high school game or a local college game or whatever it might be, you're probably not going to have access to a lot of information on who the guys are that are playing in the game. I said, so just show up, make one team, if your favorite team is the Dodgers, use their lineup from a night before. And the first batter who comes to the plate, that's a Dodgers leadoff hitter from the neck. Same thing down the road. So you'd be able to fill in the blanks with information, stats on the guy so far. The other team that's in the field, they're the San Francisco Giants. And the pitcher on the mound is whoever the Giants starter was the night before. And their defenders are who the Giants players are on a regular basis. And that's how you can end up broadcasting a game where you know nothing about any of the players on either team.
Hey, that's not bad. I mean, and by the way, Sandy Koufax warming up right now. So and that's the way I love play-by-play. It's one of my favorite parts of the game. And I have a question for you, Thom. How often are you thinking, because as a stand-up comedian, you're on stage, you have your act. Yeah. But there's this voice outside. As you're doing one bit, you're thinking, I'm going to do this bit next, and then I'm going to go into that. Or this bit won't work because, you know, there's a guy in a wheelchair or whatever it is. You're calling audibles. Are you, when you're doing play-by-play, are you have in your mind a home run call if they hit a home run, if it's the ninth inning? Is there any part of you that thinks, I'm going to say this? Is there any kind of scripted thing?
You know what? I mean, some guys do that, and God bless them. And you know, there are guys who all of a sudden you can just – I mean, I think everybody at home, there are times where a guy that's announcing will come up with some line that you knew that he thought of that beforehand. But I just was never that guy. I'm maybe just not smart enough to do it. I just wanted to make sure that I got the basics right. And so, you know – Some of the stuff, it's so reactionary. Like when I did the Derek Jeter flip in the playoffs against Oakland. I mean, everything was happening so fast. And all of a sudden this ball trickles through the infield and bam. And I mean, you can't think of anything ahead of time to say. But like, and Bill will remember going back, and he wasn't with the Reds yet. Like in 2010, when they won the division on a Jay Bruce home run in the bottom of the 10th inning. You were there. Yeah. So, I mean, those calls, you know, you just hope you don't mess them up because they're going to be played in that home team's ballpark forever. So, you know, no scripted out. I wasn't smart enough or good enough for that kind of thing.
Well, I remember you're friends with Costas, I think you said.
Yeah.
And he had the great call. I think it was, let me get this right. I think 2000 was the New York. And I forget which way it went, but I think the Yankees had clinched already and maybe it was the Mets were clinching. And when they clinched, he said, start spreading the news, New York.
Yeah.
And there's no way that wasn't scripted, but it was a great call. Great and it was line. Really, it was a great line. and not a great series, but although it was a five game series, but five close games, if I remember correctly. But
yeah,
I remember thinking that was a beauty. And just another question along these lines, and I referenced it last week. Dick Stockton, do you like that minimalism as that deep to center? We're tied up. How do you feel about that real minimalist play by play?
It all depends on who it is. I love Stockton. I mean, he was one of my favorite guys for a long time. He did a lot of the Red Sox games, probably when you were, well, you might not even be old enough. He was still there, right?
Before my time.
I mean, I love Stockton as an announcer. I think he's one of my favorites. Yes, very different on some of the things, but man, he was always on every single thing. You can't have the kind of career like he did. You know, he doesn't get mentioned a lot of the times with, you know, the Enbergs and the Michaels and the, you know, Joe Buck now is younger, but Stockton normally gets left out of that sort of, you know, that sort of plateau, and I think it's a mistake. I think he was a fantastic announcer. Do you agree, or were you weren't a big fan?
No, absolutely. I love him. I love him. I think that stuff is great. I really like that minimal, that style. And for me, I'm a Boston guy. So when I grew up, Sean McDonough was the voice of the Red Sox. And he's fantastic. And he's got that Boston sarcasm.
Yeah.
I don't know if this video, I've looked for it. I don't know if this footage exists anywhere. And I'll just get this out quick because I think we have to move to another segment. But he makes me laugh because he has that Boston sort of Irish sarcasm. And he'll be funny during the game. But there was a game where Tim Wakefield was pitching and he threw a knuckleball that didn't knuckle. And McDonough's call, as soon as he released it, McDonough went, uh-oh. And I think it was Cecil Fielder and he hit a bomb that hasn't landed yet. And it was just so perfect because you could just see it was spinning and it wasn't doing anything. And he went, uh-oh. and Cecil Fielder just destroyed it. And so he's one of my favorites. But later on, at some point, I want to have your top five comedians and my top five play-by-plays, and we'll see if the other guy makes the list.
Well, I can just tell you right now that, I mean, when I was a kid, and again, I'm a lot older than you are, but I mean, could anybody have been funnier back in his day than Richard Pryor?
No, he's the greatest. I mean, Carlin and Pryor are 1 and 1A, in my opinion.
Yeah. Incredible. All right. We're going to try these each and every week and see how it goes. We got to get to, I understand, another guest who we have coming on now. And this is a very special guest because he has one of the most critical jobs running the PBL as commissioner. Jim McCurdy, been around forever. Very interesting guy. Jim, thanks for being with us. You know, you've been a part of minor league baseball, I think, going back to the mid-'80s. You've been an owner. You've been a former president of the league. You're recognized as an expert on sports law. You're a professor emeritus at Gonzaga. You've written extensively about sports law, environmental law. I mean, is there anything that you haven't done?
Well, I don't know, Thom. How are you, Thom Brennaman?
I'm fine. How you doing?
Well, good. It's great to be on here. I'm real pleased to be with you. I think probably the most exciting addition of for the Pioneer League is the edition of the PBL Roundup Show. Isn't it great? I could look at the Pete Rose and Sir Charles, you know, interviews the whole time, and you're doing a great job. But then we got our venerable Bill Bavasi. How are you, Bill?
Good to see you. How's
good.
It going?
And Joe List, good to meet you. You're going to teach us something about impromptu, I think.
I hope so. And you're teaching me something about my bookshelf. I need to read more.
Well, I've got this. I was kind of afraid to try the backdrop type thing, or I'll be like some of you. Joe, they should give you one too, right?
I have one. My Wi-Fi wasn't working. I believe I blame.
It's good. You've saved me tonight for, you know, being the outlier here.
Jim, but, how does
young? Oh, there you go. I like it.
I got Bruce.
There you go. Bruce Springsteen, the boss. Is that right?
Yeah, big baseball fan.
Yeah. How about the Syracuse guys here? It's really good. You know, they're kind of like remember the radio reporters from the street?
Yeah.
Remember that time? And Thom, you would know there was a San Diego announcer for the Padres. After I went emeritus in Gonzaga, I went to University of San Diego Law School and taught a year and then went to their London program several times. But there was a Padres announcer who had been a radio reporter on the street, and he did not change his manner of delivery.
Yeah, I can't. I'm drawing a blank
was
on the
Wagner
name.
Or something like that. Anyway, he was just great.
Ted, Ted Leitner.
Ted Leitner. Yeah, I mean, he was fantastic. Yeah, I love that guy, too. He's a fun guy to be around. Answer a question for me, Jim. How does a guy go from being an environmental lawyer and a sports law expert to getting in the baseball business? How's that happen?
Well, Thom and all the rest, that has always been there. That would be my choice as far back as I can remember as a kid. And it may have come, I'm not sure. I was a 7-month baby, premature. And so it must have been about 9 months, 3 pounds or whatever. And Dizzy Dean was at my parents' home at a poker party.
You're kidding.
Held me up to the ceiling. My mother's terrified, of course. And he looked at my hand and fingers and said, he will be a pitcher, which was his worst projection, I think. So on. But it was just always there, always I wanted to be in. And I was really taken by the minor leagues. Now, if you can get me in as an assistant general manager of the Cincinnati Reds, I'll take it. But
I'm not on great terms with them these days, Jim. I don't think that team's happening. Maybe somewhere else.
But it was I always thought of the minor leagues. And let me tell you a couple of stories. And we don't have a lot of time to kind of go into this because I have been – I love life, and it's more of what I don't do that allows me the time to do these. I don't work on cars. I don't do home improvements. I don't drink and hang out in the bars. I don't play around. I mean, you know, so what do you do with your time? Baseball is what it is. But I wanted to say, as maybe a six-year-old, I went with my dad to the Burnett Field in Dallas, Texas. It was down on the Trinity River. There were New York Giants Farm Club at the time. And I was just enthralled with the name of Alex Cosmetis. And sometime during the game, late in the night, you had the black night, but you had a viaduct over the Trinity River, which was lit up like Golden Arch or something. And somebody hit a home run. I didn't know what it was, but it was a big deal. Everybody's going crazy and so forth. And so the next night, we're in the backyard with relatives around, and I'm showing them how you slide into home plate because we're sitting behind the plate. And I'm telling them that Alex Cosmetis hit the home run that hit the viaduct. Now, I had the opportunity to sit on a major league committee. When there's no commissioner, there are a group of owners that sit in the shoes of the commissioner. And Bud Selig chaired the committee after Faye Vincent's demise. And if there's a minor league issue, they add two minor leaguers. It was Mike Tomburo from Pawtucket and Jim McCurdy. And we're sitting there with the major league owners. But Bill White is there, if you remember Bill White.
Oh, yeah.
National League president, replaced Giamatti, if I remember. And he was the first baseman on this team. So I'm telling Bill White of what I had done in this story. And he said, well, it couldn't have been Alex because he's a little guy. And I said, yeah, and it didn't hit the viaduct either, but such is the mind of a young child at a minor league ballpark.
That's exactly right. Amen to that. Amen to that. So how's the whole thing been? And Jim, we've talked a little bit about it, not gotten into great depth, but I'm curious your whole look and view as commissioner of what the Pioneer League has gone through the last 2 years.
Oh, gosh, yeah, we all, of course, went through it together and during the, you know, the layoff year. Sure. And the negotiations with Major League Baseball and the like. And it was just great to bring in Mike Shapiro and Henry and Josh and our whole group here, Rachel, who is now with the Red Sox, and putting this together, as I think Henry had called it, something like a sports and entertainment entity. As such. And we can actually do many things now that we couldn't do as an affiliated under affiliated ball.
Which do you like better?
Oh, I like it all. It was great in the affiliations. I'm a people person, and the person, so I remember when Ray Poitament brought the Taiyo whales to us with Tata Hiro Shigomi, and we brought Japanese players to Butte, Montana, where we had the Copper Kings. The Texas Rangers with their, you know, Sandy Johnson and Marty Scott and all the people, Rudy Jaramillo,
sure,
all of them. But, you know, I want to talk, Thom, also about the Cincinnati Reds have been in the Pioneer League from 1974 through 2020.
Yeah.
It may have been the longest affiliation with one city. I heard that it was. But the great people had Chief Bender.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
Remember Chief Lois Hudson? Yeah.
Yeah, all of them. Yeah.
You know, just great. I think, was it Johnny Almanzar? Was he a farm director at one time?
Yes, he was. He was a, yeah, and they let him get away to the Atlanta Braves, which was a terrible mistake.
Yeah, so, I mean, those relationships in affiliates, can't replace them, you know, from affiliated ball. But are we having fun? I say fun and in, I guess, enjoying, but also looking at what we can do as an independent league. And, you know, I was, I know you said you were a history buff, I believe. I heard that from somebody. And you and I could take up three or four shows looking at the history of the Pioneer League. But it started in 1939. Baseball had been around our footprint forever. The soldiers brought it to the Indians and so forth, all those stories. But in 1939, a fellow named Jack Hallowell was a pharmacist in Pocatello Brothel League. Back, everything had crashed in 1929, and they had lost it all, and it took 10 years. And it came back, and we are much in a position last year in 2021 and this year as we were in 39 and 40.
Mm-hmm.
Such. And back in those days, you pretty much had independent teams, certainly in the 20s. Branch Rickey had a farm team in Pocatello. The Reds had a farm team in Ogden in 1939. And it's interesting because the Twin Falls Club was a farm team of the Spokane Hawks, who in turn were a farm team of the Seattle Rainiers. So things were very different. And you had players that had been former major leaguers like Wes Shilmerick, but you also had these career professional baseball players that played at the – and I'm not sure about the minor-major distinction in those days. And then you had the prospects like Larry Jansen that came in 1940 in our league. But I want to talk with you about a person named Tony Robello. Ever meet Tony?
Yes.
I'm sure you did.
Yeah.
Bill, you know – Tony Robello set every full season record in hitting in 1939, with the exception of batting average. He lost it in the last week, 58 home runs, and was just a stalwart for 4 years in our league. And in those days, you only had 18 players on a team and a player manager. And then the year after, in 1940, you could have 19 if the manager didn't play. But Tony Robello, can you tell us anything about Tony Robello? He went on, for those that are listening, to be the scout of the Cincinnati Reds that built the Big Red Machine. Yep. And he is reputed to be the only scout that scouted Johnny Bench as a catcher and not a pitcher. Now, is that?
Yes, that is the story as it's told. I think Johnny Bench would tell you that same story.
And Bill, any Tony Robello stories? He is the
No, I don't. No, he was a little bit before me, but he's legendary. Yeah, and in the scouting world, the guys that are the real devoted scouts, they'll know exactly who he is. And I know of him, and I know some of the stories that you're talking about. I never had.
Well, Jimmy, we got to let you go, and because we got a couple more things we got to hit before we go. But we're going to be checking in with you, if you don't mind, on a regular basis throughout the year on the Roundup Show, if that's okay by you.
Oh, of course, always. And great job, guys. You take care.
Good to see you, Jim.
All right, Jim, all the best. Well, good time now to bring in our weekly baseball commentary segment. Who's on Durst with the famed satirist comedian Will Durst? Check it out.
Will Durst here for the Pioneer Baseball League Network Roundup. And this week, I want to talk about one of the things that I think makes baseball universal. Oh, not across the universe. I mean, that everybody can relate to it. And that's because the players look like ordinary human beings. In the NBA, they're all giants. Stephen Curry is 6'3", and he's considered too short be an NBA guard. And football, forget about it. You're talking about eighth of a ton pieces of premium beef slamming into each other 20 miles an hour encased in plastic armor. That's the thing about baseball. After they retire, they'll still be able to tie their own shoes. And we all played baseball. We all played it Sandlot, high school. Maybe some of us actually tried out for organized baseball. We can all relate to those players. We've all stood in that box, run to first. We know the process. It's not true of football. Yeah, we know about running and passing, but it's not like baseball. So next week, we're going to talk about the different forms. Softball, baseball, wiffle ball. That's it for me for this week. Happy baseball, everybody.
All right, good stuff. Before we get out of here, let's check in real quick with the score in Billings. And I know that Hayden Wasserman, you're still on that game. That's Billings at Missoula, right?
Yes, sir.
What's happening there?
So Jacob Klein's continuing his fantastic game. He hit another home run basically right after we talked last. So that gives him three hits and two home runs on the day. So he's player of the game as of right now. And they're up 6-2, top of the seventh. And they got two guys on with one out, first and second, that is. So they're looking good, but, you know, game's not over. And in the Pioneer League, anyone can score 10 runs at any time. Yeah. So,
well, you know what? That already
continue, you know, keeping up with it.
And what's your Brewers update tonight, Hayden?
Oh, man. I didn't look after we were down 5-0 to the new manager, Phillies, with the worst fielding in the league, you know, with Castellanos and Schwarber both just butchering balls. So, I, you know, it's just embarrassing. Hader gave up two runs, which is not supposed to happen. That's supposed to be the one sure thing we got. So I'm not checking. A little bit of a depressed Brewers fan right now. But okay. You know what? We're the best team in the NL Central.
We'll see about that. We'll see about that.
It's not going to be your Reds, Tom. I'll tell you that.
There's no illusions about that. No, there's no question it's not them.
Yes. But, it's us and the Cardinals. That's it.
I love the Brewers, though. I love Council. I think he's done a great job. All right. Hayden, thanks. Let's check in with Carter Lewis one more time up in following Great Falls. Carter, you there?
Yep, I'm here, Tom.
What's happening?
So it's still been Great Fall. I mean, still been Glacier tonight. 12-0 in the top of the ninth. They've just been able to get it done. Every single one of their players has at least gotten one hit, and multiple of them got on base multiple times. Gabe Howell's walked twice. Brandon Warford has two hits with two RBIs and a double. Michael Nell is 1-for-3 with two walks as well. So it's really just been all Glacier tonight.
Well, Carter, while I've got you here, you have some information on the players and the pitchers of the week, correct?
Yes, I do. Yes, well, I Kevin, do.
Tell us about that.
All right. So for this week, we decided to split it up between North Division and South Division. Okay. So this week's North Division pitcher of the week, we talked to him earlier. His name is Montana Quigley. He was the 17th pick in the 2021 midseason PBL draft this past season. And last week, he pitched 3 games, 4 innings with 2 saves. And as of right now, he leads the league in saves with 3. He allowed no earned runs, only allowed 3 hits and no walks, as well as putting up 3 strikeouts. And for our batter of the week from the North Division is Calvin Estrada, an outfielder from Idaho Falls. Last week, he played 7 games, had 16 hits for a .485 batting average, 7 doubles, which puts him in the league lead doubles, and also 3 home runs.
Insane.
I know. He's an extra base hit machine. With 3 home runs, he's tied 3rd in the league in that category, 13 RBIs as well, which puts him up to 2nd in the league, and 3 stolen bases, as well as only 4 strikeouts in his last 33 at-bats. So he's been putting the bat to the ball pretty regularly. And for the South Division, for our pitcher, we have Preston Snavely from Northern Colorado Owls. He put up 6 innings pitched with only 1 earned run allowed to get his ERA down to 1.5 ERA for the year, which is 7th in the league in ERA among starters. He allowed only 5 hits, holding opponents to a .217 batting average on the day with 9 strikeouts, putting him in 10th in the league in Ks per 9 with no walks allowed. And for a batter of the week from the South Division, we have Nico Papa, an outfielder from the Grand Junction Rockies, who, in 6 games, put up 17 hits on 28 at-bats for a .607 batting average, which propels him to the league lead in hits, as well as 3 doubles, which puts him tied for 2nd in the league, and 2 home runs, as well as 10 RBIs and 3 stolen bases.
Carter, you're on your game, young man.
I mean,
were on shaky ground there for a week or two, but you got it together tonight. So well done. You know I'm kidding you, Carter.
Have a great night. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much, man. Appreciate it. Well, fellas, before we get out of here, Joe, where can I see this movie? I can't stop thinking about some of the lines from that movie on the trailer we saw. I'm having belly laughing off camera here just thinking about a couple of those.
Oh, thank you. I'm excited. Well, we're trying to figure out what theaters we're going to be in. We're doing a big New York, Boston, and Chicago premiere, and then it will be in theaters, but we have a distributor guy figuring it out. So yeah. I'll have a better list, but it'll be hopefully in some local theaters near you. And we've been encouraging fans and folks to reach out to their local theater and ask, because it's a totally independent film, and it's hard to get movies that aren't X-Men or, you know, Toy Story.
Well, I'm going to look at, we live in a tiny little town down the road that still has that old school, you know, movie theater where they have, I'm going to look into that. That's curious. Where else you playing? Where is your gigs coming up?
This weekend, Punchline in San Francisco, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Rickshaw Theater in Vancouver on Sunday, and then Magoobies in Timonium, Maryland next weekend. So if you're in Baltimore area, come on out to Magoobies. Great name.
Yeah, it is a great name. Billy, what do you got going on? You bouncing around Utah watching some baseball? What do you got going on this week?
I'm visiting family, and then I'll visit and have fun with Dave Baggett in Ogden.
Nice. Well, he seemed like a good dude.
Great guy.
Yeah, seems great like guy. All right, fellas, we're out of time. Guys, thanks to Austin, Owen, Matthias, Hayden, Carter, and the gang. Billy, thank you. Joe, thank you. Have a good week. Tom, stay healthy. God bless. And PBL Roundup Show, round three. No technical difficulties tonight. Can't thank Henry Hunter and Mike Shapiro and Jackson Shapiro and everybody who really has busted their ass after the last couple of weeks where we had some issues. But it's brand new. We're trying. They're trying the best they can. We're doing the best we can. And this thing's going to get rolling. It's going to be fun to watch the rest of the summer. Have a great night, everybody.
Across the Rocky Mountains in the morning, and it's one too many lonely nights when the highway comes to be a way of life. Seems like about the time I'm getting there, I'm going. Hear the Peter Bell whine down the solid white line.